Now me. Okay. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Welcome, everyone, to episode 251 of the Thumbstick Athletes podcast. I'm your host, Dan.
I'm Will.
Corey.
No Eric this week. Eric is welcoming his wife down to Virginia. She's finally, I guess, finished with school and moved down there. So he's helping her get settled and get all moved in and stuff. So he will be back next week, I believe, when we'll be talking about Uncharted. Uncharted, was it 4?
Yep.
Drake's Fortune?
Thieves' End.
Thieves' End. Drake's Fortune was 3, right? I don't know my Uncharted game, so.
Dan, this is the first one I've played, so. Wow. I'm the wrong person.
Eric would be screaming at us right now.
Yeah.
Just having Eric next week would help me a lot talking about it, and if he's not there, it's going to be interesting.
Yeah, I'm sure he will be, but yeah, that'll be our episode for next week. This week, we are going to be covering the letter C. If you've listened to any of our letter-based episodes before, we did A and B, obviously, but we cover things in gaming related to the letter, the alphabet. It gives us a chance to cover some stuff that we wouldn't get to otherwise, just doing a episode, our game-based episode. So, and me, it allows me to delve into some history. There's some pretty interesting history stuff with some of the game developers and publishers and you know, games too. So it's a neat idea. I'm glad Corey came up with it.
Yeah, and I actually forgot how much I liked doing this kind of episode.
Until you started doing the research for it.
Right.
Yeah.
Because you start going down that rabbit hole, and like you said, you know, we cover stuff that we wouldn't cover otherwise. And the way I like to do it is I'll pick something that's relatively familiar, which I did in this case, and then just keep getting further down into stuff that some people may have, you know, never heard of. And in fact, one of the things I'm going to talk about, I found literally no mention of on the internet.
Really?
Yep.
Awesome.
Other than one little article, which I'll talk about.
Nice.
When we get there. But yeah, it is a lot of fun just to explore that, the historical side of things.
Yep. Anyone have anything they want to tease for later on in the episode?
I mean, I played maybe 3 hours of Uncharted 4. I probably won't talk too much about it, though.
First impressions.
Yeah, I'll probably give my first impressions. I think other than that, I didn't really play anything new.
Overwatch, I'm sure.
Yeah.
We'll be talking about.
Whole lot of Overwatch.
Yeah.
But I also played Stellaris.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. So I got some lengthy impressions on my 4 hours of Stellaris that I've played.
Cool. I can't wait to hear about that. That's a game I was going to buy when it came out, but lack of funds, you know.
I hear you.
But I will be getting it at some point. Okay. Well, let's get right into our C's, shall we? Will, we'll start with you. First C.
Now, the Call of Duty series is the biggest C game that I could find, really. So, and everybody knows about that, but I wanted to get into a little bit more of the not known Call of Duty games. Mainly the ones that got canceled, and there was 3 of them that I could find. Now, one was Call of Duty Combined Forces, and I got a little bit of a description for each one. Call of Duty Combined Forces was a proposed concept draft, which was originally intended to be a sequel for the Call of Duty Finest Hour, but however, due to legal issues that arose between Spark Unlimited, Electronic Arts, and Activision, the game's drafts were never scripted to become a game. The game was projected to cost about $10.5 million to produce after the Finest Hour was complete. Eventually, Activision deemed the ideas as more of an expansion than something entirely new, causing Activision to reject the proposal and ending their contract with Spark Unlimited shortly after. No, I think Finest Hour was an expansion to the first Call of Duty, wasn't it?
I never played those back then.
Because we played Medal of Honor.
Yeah.
So
I remember we played Call of Duty 2 on 360.
Yeah.
Was like my first Call of Duty.
I played two, 3, 4 Call of Duties.
I just remember being blown away by the smoke grenades.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that, I'm trying to think, I played Call of Duty 1, which, to be honest with you, I know nothing about the Italian campaign, so that kind of Medal of Honor, but other than that, I didn't play any until 4. But that's when they got really good, so. Mm-hmm. And the next one is Call of Duty Devil's Brigade. Now, this was a canceled first-person shooter for the 360 by Underground Entertainment. This was going to be set in World War II, but it was going to be mainly focusing on the Italian campaign. Which, to be honest with you, I know nothing about the Italian campaign, so that kind of interests me. Do you know anything about the Italian campaign, Dan? Just curious. Sure,
a little bit.
Is it interesting as the overall of the war?
Yeah, lots of spaghetti.
It had its moments.
Gotcha. And the last one is Call of Duty Vietnam, which was the third-person shooter set during the Vietnam War. Was in development for at least 6 to 8 months at Sledgehammer, but the development stopped because Infinity Ward needed help finishing Modern Warfare 3 due to the employee firings and departures of 2010.
That's the one I do remember.
Yeah, they talked about it when Advanced Warfare, I'm pretty sure it was. The title that they talked about how they were working on a third-person shooter, Call of Duty, and that must have been it. And I also remember when everybody left Activision and got fired. So that was big news because that was after Modern Warfare 2 and everything like that. Mm-hmm. That's it for me for my first batch of C's.
All right, Corey, what do you got?
C is for Caesar.
Caesar.
You guys remember Caesar?
Caesar the game?
The game.
Okay.
The game Caesar. It's a franchise, actually, of city builder games by Impression Games. The last one came out in 2006, Caesar 4, which I'm not sure that I played. But the first one came out in 1992, which I'm pretty sure I played. If not the first one, I played the second one. But it came out, the first one came out for the Amiga, then was ported to the Atari ST, of which we owned for a little while. Right? Wasn't that an Atari ST, that computer?
Yeah. Yep.
And then the PC and Mac. So it takes place in Rome around the time of Christ's birth, which if you know your history, you know that that was when all was hunky-dory in Rome. And it was relatively peaceful. Rome could just pick and choose where they wanted to go take over, and that's what they did. The game is very similar to SimCity. You're building structures like libraries and schools and all that infrastructure kind of stuff, but you're also building roads and plumbing. I remember, if I have this correct, doing a lot with aqueducts in Caesar, like deciding where the aqueducts go.
Yes.
And I also remember, like, where you built a factory or something, slums would rise up around it because it was low-income workers. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Those are my very, very vague recollections of those games. But I actually went back and read a review, which I'll get to a little bit later on, about the specifics of that review that I read for the game from 1992. It said, the similarities between the two games, he's talking about SimCity, are more striking than their differences, and the newer game could easily be mistaken as a sequel for the older favorite. So, Caesar definitely took a lot of SimCity. Mm-hmm. Also in this review, I thought this was funny, players with an Adlib or Sound Blaster compatible soundboard will be treated to isolated, though frequent, sounds of the city, water flows, factories, factory hammers, and the population conversing loudly. Nice. So make sure you got that Sound Blaster audio card.
They still make those, by the way.
Really?
Yeah, they're more for like high quality recording.
Recording, not just playback?
Yeah, it's mostly for recording. We would benefit from one of those.
Eh. Screw it.
Yeah.
Temper your expectations.
USB is just fine for our purposes.
But included with the game is a 135-page instruction manual. When was the last time you saw one of those?
Yeah, it's been a while.
Yeah. Literally included every aspect of the game. Taught you what you needed to know. The difference, though, between Caesar and SimCity was the addition of a military aspect in that you created soldiers and sent them off to battle. The battles actually happened off-screen, but you handled all the logistics and expenses of the battling. That was part of the strategy for battles, rather than the act of the actual battle. But it's interesting, because in this article I read that you can import your save from Caesar to this game called Cohort 2, which was just Roman battles. So you could actually play your battles in real time from Caesar in this game, Cohort 2, by importing a save. And this was way back in 1992.
Huh.
I thought that was really interesting.
Yeah, that is really cool. Well, like Crusader Kings 2 to Europa Universalis 4. I love that.
But it'd even be more like taking like a civilization save and taking that battle and playing it out in like a Total War game.
Uh-huh.
Or like even like the, what's that medieval FPS with melee? War of the Roses.
There's that one.
Chivalry, Medieval Warfare.
Yeah.
Yeah. That stuff would be so cool.
It would be cool.
But that's Caesar. And the review I read was in an old article of Computer Gaming World, which I'll talk about next.
Nice. Okay. That everything?
That's it.
Did that game... Now, did you play as Augustus during that? Or
you played as Random Governor.
Okay.
Number two.
Okay.
Or whatever. I don't know. I don't think you were anybody specific.
Gotcha. All right. My first C is Corsair. Corsair, the computer maker of PC gaming components, including power supplies, RAM, cases, the excellent H-Series liquid cooler, solid-state drives, fans, as well as high-end keyboards, mice, and headsets. The interesting thing I found when I was doing my research on Corsair was that they're coming out with a keyboard and mouse combo called the Lapdog. It's designed for PC gaming on your couch. If anyone's seen the Razer Turret, it's similar to that. It's just this little like lap board with the full keyboard and it's got the mouse pad on the right. It all like kind of combines into one and put, you know, goes nicely into like some cupboards and not cupboards, but little containers on the thing. And yeah, they're trying to take advantage of the PC gaming on your couch trend, which I like. Whoops.
It's a nerdy display to have out.
It's very nerdy. Yeah. the Razer Turret is pretty small, so you could like stash that away. But the Lapdog looks like it's decently sized and you wouldn't be able to like store it anywhere inconspicuously. But cost. I do want to get one of these things eventually, but it'll depend on the cost. The Razer Turret is about $150 right now. But the company was founded as Corsair Microsystems in 1994 by Andy Paul, Don Lieberman, and John Beakley. Corsair originally developed Level 2 cache modules, called cache on a stick or coast modules for OEMs. After Intel incorporated the L2 cache in the processor with the release of its Pentium Pro processor family, Corsair changes focus to RAM modules, primarily in the server market. In 2002, they began shipping DRAM modules that were designed to appeal to computer enthusiasts who were using them for overclocking. I didn't realize that sort of stuff was going on way back in 2002.
No.
Since then, Corsair has continued to produce memory modules for PCs, has added other PC components as well, which I talked about. I currently have a Corsair carbide case for my computer. Keeps my stuff nice and cool. I had a Corsair power supply in my computer that kicked the bucket, so I switched over to EVGA after that for my power supply. But it was one of the cheap ones. I didn't expect it to last. I think it lasted me like 2 years before I needed to get a new one. But like I said, it was just their cheap base model power supply.
You said Corsair does Razer, right?
No.
Oh, I had you confused.
No, Corsair Lapdog is similar to the Razer Turret.
Oh, gotcha. That's where Razer comes in. Okay.
Yep. The PC gaming on your couch with keyboard and mouse. Companies are starting to take that route with some of their hardware.
So you follow this stuff pretty closely, Dan. Where does Corsair rank on the PC component echelon?
Corsair RAM is still some of the best.
Okay.
Especially the Corsair Vengeance Pro RAM. That's really, really good RAM. As far as everything else, like everyone has their own, you know, their own stuff that they like, you know. It's hard to tell, but yeah, their RAM is very highly regarded. power supplies in general too. Like I said, I didn't have any luck with their baseline power supply. I really like my Corsair carbide case. It was inexpensive, which is nice. And it's nice looking and pretty well built. So, but it was only $50, which is the best part. You know, you can spend up to like $150-$200 on a computer case.
Right.
So, yeah. Oh, the liquid coolers too are very highly reviewed. The H series liquid coolers. I thought about getting one for my graphics card and liquid cooling my graphics card.
You need that though?
It allows for very heavy overclocking, and it keeps the temperatures really low on your graphics card. That being more helpful for PC gaming than an overclocked processor. You know?
Gotcha. Yeah, I guess. How much is one of those liquid cooler things?
The cheapest ones are like $50 or $60. And then if you get a special bracket for it, it's another like 30.
Yeah. So if you can spend that money to upgrade to what would cost you, you know, another couple $100 for video cards.
Graphics card.
Probably worth it.
Sure. Oh, we'll be talking graphics cards again later during Nibble Bits.
Oh, boy.
Just a little tease.
Oh, that's right. I'm excited to hear about the new.
Yeah. It's new one. Exciting news, at least for me.
It's been a while, right? Didn't they skip a year?
Yeah, it's been 2 years, I think, since they launched the 900 series cards. So it has been a while.
Excellent.
Yeah. So that's Corsair. Will, what do you got?
Well, Dan, I've got Chuck E. Cheese sports games. Now, I'm going to read you off the features. By the way, if you were to guess what console this was for, what would you guess?
Sega Dreamcast.
No, think more recent.
Come on, Dan. Chuck E. Cheese sports. I only know the answer because I called up the YouTube video.
Haven't the foggiest.
Come on, Dan.
You know it without knowing it.
You subconsciously know it.
Engage.
I'm just going to say it. Nintendo Wii.
Oh, of course.
Yeah.
Oh, you're right. Obvious. I should have
As soon as I read the title, I'm like, this is a Wii game, that's for sure.
Wii exclusive.
Sure enough. I'm going to read some of the features it has. Avatar creation. Choose from 6 unique avatars and see how their story pans out. So there's story in this game.
Shut up. I'm really into the Chuck E. Cheese lore, so I got to get this.
This might be a hidden gem that we never played.
Could be.
Perfect fun for the whole family. Enjoy more than 18 game variations starring Chuck E. Cheese and his international group of friends. Extended replayability with over 50 prizes to earn, new games to discover, and an online leaderboard to spur competition and repeated play. This title contains hours of excitement. Huh. Nice. The selling points are amazing on this. And ease of use. Some gameplay mechanics with low learning curve that mimic the game at the retail Chuck E. Cheese locations will have your family playing in no time. Use the Wii-enabled controls to whack-a-munch, shoot some hoops, and make pizzas, and so much more.
Hmm. I'm watching a video of Chuck E. Cheese playing baseball. It looks just like Wii Sports Baseball.
It does, but just with way poorer graphics.
Yeah.
Poor, huh?
I wonder how much this game costs. Let's look.
You could probably get it from GameStop for like $60.
Alright. So the cheapest that I'm finding on Amazon is $35.
Wow.
Used in good condition. The most expensive and very good condition is $113.
Wow. What are some of the reviews? What's the review score?
Well, it's running at a 4-star for 26 reviews. This is on Amazon. Fun game, a good game for young kids, a bit overpriced. That person gets it.
Yep.
Another one is just Chuck E. Cheese. This game saved my life.
That's a troll.
Yeah. Yeah, that's... The lowest is a 3-star, so... This game's alright, then.
Hey, here's a fun fact.
What's that?
Do you guys know what the E stands for in Chuck E. Cheese?
Everyone.
Ecstasy? Is that what you said, Dan?
Yeah.
Entertainment. Chuck Entertainment Cheese.
Huh.
Yeah. It's dumb.
Don't ever let your kids play in the ball pit in Chuck E. Cheese.
No, God, no.
Horror stories of some of the stuff they find at the bottom of those things.
Did you also know that he is now a mouse, and prior to 1995, he was a rat? So
I mean, it makes more sense to have him be a mouse instead of a rat.
Yeah.
Does it?
Sure.
Have you been to a Chuck E. Cheese in the last decade, Dan?
No, but for marketing purposes, it's probably easier to market Chuck E. Cheese as a mouse instead of a rat.
Fair enough.
Yeah, because when I think of rats, I think of the Black Plague. And when I think of a mouse, I just think of annoying house rodent.
Quick side note for rats and the Black Plague. I was cleaning out. We have this fountain at work, and as a groundskeeper, it is my job to take care of. Now it is. It was part of another building that wasn't under our control until the last week or so, but that's a whole other side story. But there's this fountain with a little pond in it, and I was told I needed to clean it out because it was disgusting. So I went to clean it out, and there's this big lump of something floating in the water. And I was, like, paddling around the water trying to bring it closer to me so I could pull it out. And and it looked furry, and I was like, this isn't good. So I took a board and picked it up out of the water with the board, and immediately just the worst stench of roadkill.
Ugh.
And sure enough, it was a giant rat that was floating in this little itty-bitty pond with this fountain in it.
Ugh, that's gross.
You just want to dump bleach in it.
Oh, it's disgusting. But, you know, my hands touch the water, so I'm just waiting to find out that I have the plague.
Yeah.
Be one it's of about... the... How many cases a year of bubonic plague? It's like two.
Not very many.
Something like that.
Is it curable now?
Yeah. Well, right. As long as they catch it.
Which, worth his time for go to the hospital, so.
Yeah. Exactly.
Well, Corey.
See you
enjoy.
Guys.
Enjoy.
It's my final podcast.
That's it for Chuck E. Cheese that I got, Dan.
All right. Corey, number two.
Number two, Computer Gaming World. So I read the review for Caesar, which was written by Alan Greenberg, titled All Code Leads to Rome. And this was in issue 107 of Computer Gaming World magazine. The magazine itself was founded by Russell Sipe. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly. But fun fact, he gave up on his studies to be a Baptist minister to start Computer Gaming World. He had no publishing experience, just loved games, and realized that there was no publication specifically covering computer games. So he's like, I'll do that. The first issue came out in November of 1981.
Wow.
It survived the video game crash of 1983, which, according to Wikipedia, 18 other color PC gaming magazines did not, and Computer Gaming World was the only one that did survive. And just about the video game crash, which would have been another good one to do, because I guess you could kind of use Crash.
Crash,
is that. But in 1983, so revenues of the video game industry in 1983 were $3.2 billion. And after the crash, in 1985, revenues were only $100 million, which is a 97% drop.
That's crazy.
In revenues. That is insane. The main cause was saturation. There were too many different platforms, hardware, and way too many bad games.
Yep. A lot of really bad first part, not first party titles. Licensed.
Right.
A lot of really bad licensed titles, especially.
Rushed out, bad, badly licensed. I don't think that could ever happen again. Only because
there's too many choices now. Like, I think people would. You know, there's too much information, too. Like, people generally don't buy the really bad garbage because they've known about it for a while, you know?
Exactly. That's exactly what I was going to say. It's not like the old days where you walk into a store and you're like, oh, this cover looks nice.
Yeah.
Oh, they have a good quote on the back. The game must be good. Like, no, nowadays you kind of know.
Yeah.
Even if you go into, like, the app store and see what's popular, it's generally popular for a reason.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
The magazine was sold to Ziff Davis, who we all know and love, in 1993, and it continued to grow until the internet became a thing and was ubiquitous. everywhere. And then from there, sort of declined, and the last issue was in November of 2006, at which point the magazine was rebranded Games for Windows, the official magazine, which is no longer around. And that was based off the Games for Windows Live branding kind of thing. So,
oh, wow. Which also didn't survive.
Yeah. No, it did not. But after that, Ziff Davis was kind enough to put the Computer Gaming World Archive online, which included the first 100 issues of the magazine spanning 11 years, all in searchable PDF format.
Awesome.
Which is really nice. But Ziff Davis has since taken that archive down, but you can now access every issue of Computer Gaming World at cgwmuseum.org, which is where I read issue 107, which is from June of 93, 164 pages in that magazine. And I actually read a little fun fact that Computer Gaming World, it was chock full. It was a huge magazine, and their biggest one was 500 pages.
Holy crap.
For a monthly magazine about wow. computer games. So yeah, issue 107, the one I read through quickly, Hellcab was on the cover. I never heard of Hellcab. You guys?
No.
Nope.
Nah.
Okay. The first ad on the first page that you open up to is for a game called Spear of Destiny, a Wolfenstein 3D graphic adventure. Cool. I don't know.
The Spear of Destiny was supposedly the spear that the Roman soldier used to stab Christ when he was on the when he's being crucified. Huh. That's what the Spear of Destiny is.
Interesting. I didn't know
that. Nazis, the Nazis were interested in finding relics like that. So that could be what the relation to Wolfenstein is.
That would make sense.
Oh yeah.
Look at Dan dropping knowledge on us.
You know.
Some of the other features in the issue, X-Wing, article titled X-Wing Takes Flight, How to Win at Space Word Ho. I don't know what that is. But they also had and this was advertised on the cover, a special sports game section in this issue, which led me to find a little game called CCC Challenge Cup Hockey.
Ooh.
Which I will talk about a little bit later on.
Nice. Okay. Good stuff. All right. My next one is CD Projekt Red. They are obviously the creators of the Witcher series of video games and the DRM-free game service, GOG.com. CD Projekt Red was founded in 1994 by Marcin Owinski and Mikhail Kaczynski. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing those right, but they started with $2,000 and a rent-free flat they borrowed from a friend.
Cool.
About that.
That's how I want to start everything.
Absolutely.
Same.
With less than $2,000, though. $200.
Yeah.
Owinski and Kaczynski both enjoyed games as children, but games were hard to come by in Poland due to being under the influence of the Soviet Union. As younger men, they both sold cracked copies of Western games in Polish marketplaces. So when they formed CD Projekt Red, they wanted to legitimize the video game market in Poland. So they imported and localized Western games.
Legally?
Yeah.
Or just like on their own, kind of?
No, legally. They specifically worked with BioWare and Interplay to import and localize Baldur's Gate, which ended up being quite successful for them. I think it was like they sold 18,000 copies on the first day, which was a huge success.
Wow.
Back then, yeah.
I'll say.
They continued to work with Interplay on a PC port of Baldur's Gate Dark Alliance, but Interplay's financial troubles led to the cancellation of the project. The scrap code from Baldur's Gate Dark Alliance, though, through some stops and starts and reorganizations, eventually ended up helping in the development of 2007's The Witcher. So,
look at that.
The rest is history.
That's crazy to go from pirate salesman to creating The Witcher.
Yeah, that was really interesting to me. You know, you don't think about that sort of thing, but yeah, after the Soviet Union collapsed, like those all the satellite states of the Soviet Union were like they're on their own, you know, and it took a while for the market to finally like right itself, you know. And it said something like they didn't have any intellectual property rights or anything like that in Poland, so people were just pirating games like crazy and selling them on the streets and in marketplaces, and that was how the Polish got their games back in the day.
That's so cool.
That's crazy. Yeah. Wow.
Yep.
And then you watch. I got footage of The Witcher 3 playing in the chat, and I don't know. It's just it's so funny. What year around was that before when they started? Do you have that?
CD Projekt Red started in 1994, so I guess it was at some point before that.
Gotcha.
Probably late or early 90s, late 80s, early 90s. The Soviet Union fell in 89, 88.
Your guess is better than mine.
Yeah, I don't know.
I'm going to go 88.
I feel like it was the late 80s when it finally fully collapsed.
It's also interesting, like, are there other Eastern European game companies that have, like, cracked the international market?
The developers of the Metro series are from the Ukraine.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
But I think they relocated because of the civil unrest in the Ukraine.
Why do I want to say like Amsterdam or something like that?
Yeah, it might be.
I've got a game developer that, is from a different country that put out games that we know.
What's that?
Cauldron. Yep. It is a Slovak video game developer located in Bratislava, Slovakia. The studio was founded in 1996 with their first project, Quadrex, being released in the same year. And according to the official website, they currently have 25 employees working for them. But in 2014, Bohemia Interactive purchased Cauldron Studios, whose 25 developers are now added to the DayZ development team.
Uh-huh.
Now, the game that they put out that we all know is another C, Cabela Big Game Hunter.
Yeah.
Yeah, right? Now, I'm not going to get into details about Cabela because there's like six games of them.
There's a bunch.
And it's all the same. You're just killing big animals.
And I'm pretty sure for the bees, I talked at length about Big Buck Hunter. So
if you're interested in the review of Cabela, go to B and listen to Big Buck Hunter.
Bohemia does Arma too, right?
Yep.
Series. Those are very well respected combat first person shooter games. Oh, that's right. Did they buy DayZ?
Dean Hall sold it to them.
Okay. That's what I thought.
And because he realized the game got bigger than what he could do.
Yep.
So,
Dan, before we move on too far from that.
Sure.
The 4A Games, the developer of Metro.
Yeah.
They're operating in Kiev, Ukraine.
Okay.
But they also opened a new studio in Malta.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
That would be the place to go.
I guess, yeah.
So are they okay?
I think what they did is I think they moved out like a lot of their people out of Kiev when it was really messy there, was 2 years ago or whatever.
Yes, I think 2014 is the date, yeah.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah, that was it for my C there, Dan.
Cauldron. Cool.
What do you got next, Corey?
So as I mentioned, CC Challenge Cup Hockey, which is a text-based hockey game.
Text-based hockey game.
So as I mentioned, I was reading this in issue 107 of Computer Gaming World. And this is the game I said at the top of the episode I found literally no mention of on the internet other than
that article.
Yep, in this archived PDF of Computer Gaming World. So the review in that issue was by Joe Scherfe, who I thought this was interesting. Started by talking about how the NHL has a hard time conveying the action, like beauty and drama of hockey on TV, which I think is still somewhat true.
Yeah.
We always recommend if you're the least bit interested in hockey, go to a game. Don't watch it on TV because it's a huge difference.
Yep.
And he continued to compare that to video games and how putting it on a monitor, which at the time much smaller than TVs, is even harder, you know, than just trying to put it on a TV. So he said the solution is to stick to the stats and don't bother with the action. Which is also kind of
I like to hear.
Oh yeah, it's also kind of interesting because there are still hockey management sims.
Eastside Hockey Manager. I just got the new one. Not that long ago.
Yeah, I bought it for $5 today, actually.
Yeah, I got it as part of the Sega Strategy Humble Bundle.
There you go. So Challenge Cup Hockey makes you the front office manager and coach, just like our modern hockey sims. But it is text-based, so keep that in mind. The main menu options are to play a game, review stats, set up a league, schedule league games, and access and edit player data. Once you start whatever, you choose a team, and the article specifically mentioned Tampa, Anaheim, and Ottawa, which are in fact included. Those were the new expansion teams that year.
Wow.
So that's why they specifically mentioned that, which I thought was kind of funny. Before you start the game, you review your lineup and shuffle the lines as you see fit, which is something we see in all hockey games these days. And the goal is to get your team to play up to its potential, which he made another joke here, saying that hopefully in the Sharks' case, you can make the team live up to beyond its potential, because I guess the Sharks were really bad that year. And from there, it's from what I understand in his description, it's kind of like watching a crude version of the NHL's live stat tracker thing where it shows shots and all that stuff. But it's all in ASCII. It's all text-based. So you see your players, but they're just little figures. And the an actual text reads out like a radio announcer describing the action. Like, oh, there's a big hit at center ice, and, you know, oh, there's a shot on goal, and you just read that text. But you decide, the actual gameplay part of it is you decide when to send in a fresh line, change your goalie, all that kind of stuff. But you can also alter the style of play on the fly, and your options there are normal, offensive, defensive, and physical. So that's what you do in CC Challenge Cup Hockey. One thing that really killed me was at the very end of the review, there was a footnote that basically said that there was an updated version of the game that was released after the magazine went to print. And it included a short little blurb about what the updates were to the game. But then the last line reads, quote, "For more information on the update, the designer can be reached at the phone number above."
Yeah.
And there is, for every game they talk about in computer gaming world, back in the day, there's a little box. It says the cost of the game, the developer, the publisher's name, their address, and phone number. Yep. And they encourage you to call.
We really had to rough it back in the day, you know?
I mean, is that roughing it? Or could I just, like, call Blizzard and say, yo, man, Overwatch is causing me fits.
Yeah.
Like, I need some tips.
Yeah, give me some tips.
You probably could. That would be interesting.
That would be interesting. But yeah, again, I found literally no mention of it on the internet anywhere, and it just kind of hit home that, like, it's important to preserve. And it's great that they preserved all those issues of computer gaming world, because that game would be forgotten to time.
Yeah.
You know, other than people that remember playing it.
Handful of people.
Yeah.
Can we get our hands on a copy?
I was wondering that. I don't know. Maybe I could dig it up somehow and see who owns the IP for Challenge Cup Hockey, and maybe, you know, send out some tweets or something like that. But
that's something. That's one of the games that should go on GOG. They should just put as many old games as they can find up if there's any way of getting them up.
Yeah, I mean, there should be. I think there is like a video game archive kind of thing, isn't there?
Yeah.
But it should be something that's like totally open and free to use. Like, you can download the source code and the game itself if you can get it to run and all that stuff. Like, full open source access to all this stuff. That'd be really interesting.
That would be awesome.
But that was also the golden age of hockey, in my opinion, was
early
90s.
Sure.
The Gretzky days. And when the Rangers won a cup.
We're far from that.
Yeah.
Okay. My last one. I only got three this time. Crusader Kings series.
Ooh.
Developed by and published by Paradox. It is a medieval real-time strategy games where the goal is to build a dynasty instead of a kingdom. That was an important distinction that the Crusader Kings did. It was more about preserving your lineage than it was building a kingdom. You go through the entire game from the very beginning, which at least in the original Crusader Kings 2 was 1066 to 1453. As long as you could preserve your family line, even if you were just a lowly baron, you could quote unquote complete the game, which is cool. You know, you could lay low the entire course of almost 400 years. The
like
original
Switzerland.
What's that?
You could be like Switzerland and be neutral.
Be neutral, yeah. The original Crusader Kings was released in September of 2004. Crusader Kings 2 in February of 2012. And yeah, the game ends when a player dies with no heirs or when the year turns 1453. I've spent well over 200 hours playing Crusader Kings 2. And I love it to death.
Did that crack your top games list?
I think so. I think it did. I think it was in the top 10.
Okay.
If I remember correctly. But yeah, it's different too in the real-time strategy. It's not fast-paced like a Age of Empires or like a StarCraft or something like that. It's very slow-paced. You know, you're in it for the long game. You can speed up and slow down time as much as you want, or pause the game to make moves. Like, you know, I would have things go relatively quickly until you started a war with somebody. Then you slow things down so you can, you know, keep track of unit troop movements and stuff.
Oh, it is real time.
Yeah, it's real time.
Gotcha. Okay. I always thought it was turn-based.
Yeah. You played it, didn't you?
A little bit, yeah. I couldn't crack the nut, and at the time I wasn't willing to give it what it needed for me to enjoy it.
I can totally understand why. I actually had to look up beginner tips because part of the reason was I started in like Eastern Europe, and you know you're surrounded by hostile enemies, not knowing how to play the game. It wasn't until I read the best tip I read for Crusader Kings 2 was to start as one of the Irish, one of the little Irish, I guess duchies maybe, and to go from there, because you're kind of isolated. You don't have to worry about England at the time because they're being invaded by Norway, so they're busy fighting off Norway to not bother Ireland at all. You can kind of learn the game. And my goal, at least initially, was to take over all of Ireland and form the Kingdom of Ireland, which I did. And in my longest game that I actually carried into Europa Universalis 4, I formed from Ireland. I started in one of the southern parts of Ireland. I took over all of Britain and formed the Empire of Britannia. I took over parts of Scandinavia and parts. I took over Brittany in France, and then that was the game that I continued into Europa Universalis 4, and I took over most of North America too.
Oh wow!
Yeah,
impressive.
Cool. Yeah.
Wait, who starts in North America?
That was in Europa Universalis 4.
Oh, so it was the Americas at that point.
Yeah, that was after.
Gotcha.
But the entire time I was plagued by the Carpathian Empire, who we had just constant warfare with. They were my absolute worst enemy.
Hated enemy.
Yeah. We fought all of Crusader Kings 2. We fought all of Europa Universalis 4. It was brutal.
Now, what Paradox game is it? It's the World War II one?
Hearts of Iron.
Hearts of Iron. Is that out yet?
No, Hearts of Iron 4, I think, is coming out the beginning of June.
Okay.
If I remember correctly, that's one I'm going to get to.
I kind of want to play that one.
Yeah. I have Hearts of Iron 2 and 3. I know I at least have 3.
Oh, really? Okay.
I never got around to playing it, but I do want to. I'm definitely going to play 4.
Gotcha.
Yeah. But good stuff.
We'll be talking a little more Paradox later on because, like I said, yep. I played some Stellaris. So,
all right, well, next C.
I mean, do you guys want to hear about Cake Mania or nah?
Yeah.
Of course.
Okay. Cake Mania is the name of a series of cooking and time management video games published by Sandlot Games in 2006.
Oi.
There's a Wii version. Go figure, the Wii. Really bringing in the third-party titles. called Cake Mania in the Mix. So the plot of this game is Jill Evans, who has, inspired by her baker grandparents, developed a love for pastry cooking and went to culinary school. When Jill comes back from culinary school, she finds her grandparents' bakery, Evans Bakery, closed. Jill decides to open her own bakery and work her way up the business ladder so she can buy back her grandparents' bakery. She also learns how to deal with some very tricky customers along the way. In Cook Mania, back to the bakery, Jill tries to win her grandparents a Hawaiian cruise vacation while renovating the bakery. In Cake Mania 3, Jill is about to get married, but gets sent back in time to different periods, including prehistoric dinosaur times.
What?
In ancient China.
Does she make prehistoric dinosaur cakes?
I have no idea.
From dinosaur eggs?
There is a clarification needed next to that part on the Wikipedia.
That might just be a troll.
Is Cake Mania 3 even... I'm going to look up Cake Mania 3, because that might be the most interesting one.
Yeah, that's where the game developers, that's where they spent all their money on booze and strippers.
Went for it.
There was another one of those that went out. Somebody's Kickstarter. The guy spent all his money on a house.
Oh, really?
Yeah. The game. But
so I looked up Cake Mania 3, and I see a picture of what appears to be Jill Evans cooking for some Chinese.
Who is Jill Evans?
The protagonist of the Cake Mania series.
Is she based on a real person? Like, is there Jill Evans cooking on the HGN or something?
Well, Google will tell us this. Jill.
I'd play Julia Child cooking game.
Evans is a member of Parliament.
No.
That's just a common name.
Is it Julia Child? Bon appetit!
Is this a movie question?
No, it's a person. A famous cook. The Art of French Cooking. A bon appetit! Remember she used butter and everything? You wouldn't know. You're too young.
No. The only thing I got out of that is bon appetit.
Bon appetit!
That's all the interesting stuff for Cake Mania. It's basically like you fill out orders for those tricky customers at the game.
The series really took a turn in the third game, huh?
To be honest with you, I didn't read that description until I just now. So that was pretty crazy.
Yeah, nice.
I might add that on my backlog.
Yeah. Okay. What do you got next, Corey?
That's it. I just had those three.
Nice. What do you got, Will?
That's all I had. I had four.
Oh, beautiful. So we're all set with the main segment, huh? All right. Yeah. Shall we get into Nibble Bits?
Sure.
All right. Corey. What do you got for Nibble Bits?
Let's see here. Nintendo's Fire Emblem and Animal Crossing will be free to start, according to DNA's... See, I've been studying Japanese a little bit, so I'm going to try to pronounce his name. DNA's CEO, Isao Moriyasu. Mm-hmm.
That sounded good.
Does that sound good?
Yeah.
Okay. No additional details at the moment. But I wanted to ask you guys, what does that look like, a free-to-start Fire Emblem? Animal Crossing.
The first three chapters of a Fire Emblem game you can play for free, and then maybe you have to buy the other ones after that.
I wish it were that, but my fear is that it's something a little bit more sinister. Like, the big speculation is that if your character dies, you know, permadeath is a thing.
Bring them back.
Unless you spend $2, and then they come back.
I do know that on Nintendo's most recent earnings thing, that Fire Emblem has been bumped up to from a secondary series to a core series for Nintendo. So they're gonna be doing anything with that series to cash in some more. So who knows? I mean, I hope it's not like that. I hope it's kind of just a Fire Emblem light game.
Yeah.
This is hopeful thinking, but a whole new Fire Emblem experience, but really just dumbed down.
Yeah. So I'm thinking maybe it's the type of thing, relationships are big in Fire Emblem, right? Building relationships with certain characters. Maybe, you know, you spend some real world money to get some in-game items that you give for gifts to increase your relationship with a certain other person.
Well, like in the new ones, you can give accessories to your part of your army, and that boosts relationship with them. Like maybe it's something like that.
Yeah, I would be okay with like a fatigue meter. Like your characters have some sort of fatigue, and they can't go into battle unless that fatigue has recharged or something. I think something like that would work pretty well in Fire Emblem. It would, because I could easily, you know, if it's on my phone, I could easily just put it down and wait for that fatigue meter to recharge.
Sure. The only way they can do this without it feeling dirty is by paying, like, you know,
per episode.
Yeah, per chapter or whatever.
I don't think they will.
I don't think so either.
Just based on what we've seen in the other ones, you know, the Pokemon Shuffles and the Miitomo. I don't think we're going to get that.
Yeah, and I don't even want to begin to think what will happen with Animal Crossing. That might be worse.
I haven't played enough Animal Crossing to speculate.
Yeah, I don't know how that would work, because I haven't played any Animal Crossing either.
Well, because that's like a building game, like you can farm for resources and stuff like that. Like, so I could see like a, I don't know, like your normal town builder game, but like you can spend some money to speed up the building.
Or, I know Animal Crossing is big on time.
Yeah.
Spend some money to stop time. You know, because only certain items are available at a certain time. Like, I think even one day out of the year kind of thing, like, you can get a certain item.
Yeah.
I don't know. We shall see.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to find out what they do.
I mean, I'm going to play them regardless, but I don't think I've ever spent money on a free-to-play game.
I spent a little money on Fallout Shelter, but it wasn't actual money. It was free Google Play credit.
And that was just for science.
Yeah. Yeah, I wanted to get a full, you know, the full enjoyment I possibly could out of the 3 or 4 days that I played it.
Yeah, I don't blame you. Speaking of Nintendo, the 2DS will receive a $20 price cut to bring it down to $80. And that will happen on May 20th. So do not buy Nintendo 2DS.
Nope.
In the next 9 days, as of the recording of this podcast. And also, a lot of them come with Mario Kart 7, so that's a pretty good value. I mean, what's that's that retailing for? $40 these days?
It's probably at least 30 still.
Yeah, so, I mean, you're getting a 2DS for $50, you know,
yeah,
if you include that. Mario Kart 7, excuse me, deduction, which is a really good price, and it's a good way to play some 3DS games that you haven't been able to, like Fire Emblem.
Yep. There's a lot of good ones.
Indeed. Microsoft has launched a number of improvements to its Universal Windows platform. We didn't talk about this last week, did we?
No.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure. And Dan, you got to help me out with this, because they added support for things I don't know what they mean. FreeSync, G-Sync, and unlocked frame rates, which I know what the last one is, but the other two, I'm not sure.
Okay, so G-Sync is NVIDIA's synchronization, the video card with, or the game that you're playing with the monitor refresh rate, so you don't see any duplicate frames.
All right, okay. So
that's the one, you know, if you put it on unlocked frame rate and, you know, your game varies from like 50 frames per second to 80 frames per second, you still won't see any repeat frames. It'll be smooth throughout. And then FreeSync is just AMD's version of G-Sync.
Why don't they just use the same word?
I don't know. It's different. FreeSync is actually open source too, so like anyone could put FreeSync or build. How is it? Build FreeSync monitors or whatever. Anyone can use it.
Or build like, that option into their games.
The Intel HD series integrated graphics could use AMD's FreeSync if they wanted.
Gotcha.
So
what's VSync?
VSync is the synchronization with your monitor, with your monitor refresh rate.
Okay.
So like I turn VSync on my games a lot of times to, because it helps eliminate tearing. So it'll lock games at 60 frames per second.
Gotcha.
Because a lot of times I'll get tearing if I don't have VSync on, and I can't stand tearing.
You get a lot of tearing.
Yeah. Try VSync.
I should try VSync.
But you got to make sure that your graphics card, your game stays like above 60, even if it's just slightly above 60. Some dips aren't bad. but it still annoys me a little bit.
I don't believe I've had enough. I don't monitor my frames per second, and I'm pretty sure most games I play don't consistently run at 60.
Yeah.
But
some are worse than others with repeat frames.
Okay.
Like
this is
also
foreign to me.
Dark Souls 3 got kind of bad with some of the frame rate dips, but like Tomb Raider, Rise of the Tomb Raider, even when I had dips, like it wasn't very bad, and they were barely noticeable. It just depends on the game.
Okay. Interesting.
Yeah.
But that's at least a step in the right direction for Windows games. I mean, I know we talked about Quantum Break being a mess on PC. And I still like the idea of Xbox games coming to PC, but people seemed really upset about the way they restricted the graphical options, so this sounds like a step in the right direction.
Not just that, like overlays and stuff you can't use, like Fraps is a popular frame rate thing and that people use to record, and I'm pretty sure you can't use that when you're playing games from the Windows Store. So,
well, hopefully they continue and continue on with this sort of stuff. And
no, hopefully they just put their damn games on Steam.
Yeah, good luck with that.
I know. They would make so much more money if they just put their games on Steam. You're talking about Steam having 130 million users or whatever. I know there's a lot of people using Windows 10, but like, I downloaded the new Forza, the new free Forza.
Yeah.
I haven't played it yet, but that was like the first time I had been in the Windows Store for anything.
Yeah, I'm with you.
And, you know, I'm someone that's familiar with that sort of stuff, and I just avoid it.
They're probably trying to think long-term, though, for this stuff. And, yeah, like, putting the game on Steam would net them a good amount of money right now, but maybe they have a long play.
I'm sure they do.
That probably won't ever pan out anyway, so probably might as well throw in the towel now. Look how well Games for Windows Live worked out.
You could have it both ways. Ubisoft puts games on Steam and games on their own client. You still have to use their own client, but
at least they can be purchased through Steam.
Yeah, exactly. It could be the same type of situation.
Masquerade is a Steam game that launches a separate executable.
Yep, separate client.
Yeah, it's not a bad idea. They have their cake and eat it too.
Yep.
Disney shut down Disney Infinity and closed Avalanche Software. I was surprised by this.
Yeah, that surprised me too.
So according to an internal memo that was sent to employees, quote, despite Disney Infinity's quality, it has become difficult to financially justify continued investment given the lack of growth in the toys to life market, coupled with high development costs. The economics of our current vertical business model no longer add up.
Aww.
Huh. I was under the impression that toys to life was a big, big market.
Maybe not for Disney.
I guess. I mean, I don't know. Activision and Skylander seem to be doing just fine.
Yeah.
The Nintendo
Amiibos
seem to be doing extremely well.
Yeah.
So I kind of found myself asking why. You know, why shut it down? I thought that sales were relatively good. I could be wrong. The reception was decent. But I guess the biggest complaint is like the gameplay in those games are just not good compared to the other ones.
Sure.
But that seems easily remedied.
Yeah. Spend a little more money on development.
Yeah, make a better game. I mean, you've got all these toys out in the market. Continue to utilize them the way Skylanders does and Amiibos. And I mean, I don't know. It seemed a little crazy to me, but
the thing I preferred about Skylanders was the creativity of the characters and stuff. You know, it reminds me a little bit of Pokemon. Like every new version has a bunch of new characters. And I think like if the whole Star Wars thing didn't quite make them the amount of money that they wanted, you know, Star Wars being one of the most iconic, pop culture icons there is, you know, if that didn't make them the kind of money they want, they probably thought, you know, well, this is kind of hopeless.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, that's coming from 65-year-old you versus kids. You know, kids love Frozen.
Yeah. Yeah, but I mean, at the same time, like, what's the crossover on the kids that love Frozen that are going to be sitting down and playing Disney Infinity?
That's another part of it. Like, it does that crossover even exist?
Right, or you would get you know a couple of your favorite characters and that's it, you know.
Yep.
Like, I know with Skylanders too, they make it so for every version of the game, you have to, in order to unlock everything and see everything, you have to have a certain amount of new characters.
Yeah.
And new in this case, for last year's version, it was, you know, vehicles. There's three different, you know, land, sea, and air vehicles. You had to have at least one of each to be able to access everything. So,
I honestly think they would have been better off digging into the Disney well and bringing back, like, Looney Tunes characters that speak to our generation a little bit more.
Looney Tunes isn't Disney.
Yeah, it is.
Warner Brothers.
Yeah, it is Warner Brothers.
I'm pretty sure.
Was it always?
Are you talking about like Donald Duck?
Yeah, that's not, maybe that's a better example. Yeah, maybe
not,
I just,
that's not Looney Tunes.
Just have them confused. But
Looney Tunes is Warner Brothers.
Yeah, like our generation's appreciation for Disney characters.
Yeah. I mean, they had like the Pirates of the Caribbean characters, like Captain Jack Sparrow, which, you know, that's a decent one. Stuff like that. I mean, you couldn't really get the Mighty Ducks characters on the Disney Infinity toy.
Why not? That
would be something from our era.
Or how about, like, Herb Brooks from the movie Miracle?
Thanks.
That'd be all right.
Yeah. Again!
The Herb Brooks simulator.
Yeah.
You just tap a button to say again.
Can we make that game?
That's fun.
I feel like we could.
We could definitely make that game.
Well, there was the meme with the shootout with Oshi when he kept going out again. You know, when how many times did he go out?
It was six, I think, wasn't it?
Yeah. It was like that, but it was Herb Brooks, you know, saying again, and then Oshi going to score a goal, Herb Brooks saying again, and Oshi going out and scoring a goal.
What a classic. Yeah.
It was a picture of Oshi's face looking tired, kind of. And then Herb Brooks, like, the next picture was again of Herb Brooks just looking. And then it's Oshi skating with the puck again.
if you don't know what we're talking about, it was the Sochi?
Yeah.
Sochi Olympics, TJ Oshi, American hockey player. Playing the Russians, went to whatever overtime into a shootout, and Oshi repeatedly shot for the Americans and single-handedly beat the Russians.
Yeah, I think how the shootouts in international work is you have an overtime period, and then you go into the shootout and you pick five players to go in your shootout, and after all five go once, then you can have whoever you want of those five players go again.
Yeah.
Oshi being the best shootout guy that we had went repeatedly, like you said, five or six times maybe more.
Good stuff.
Yeah.
I'm glad Oshi will be immortalized because of that. He doesn't need to win a cup now.
Yeah. No, he doesn't. American hero.
Indeed.
He won our hearts when they said, "You're an American hero." And he said, "No, I'm not. The people overseas in camo are."
What a guy.
Exactly.
Yep. What a guy.
I'd be like, yeah, I'm a hero.
Right. Yeah. Remember to talk about team captains when we get to our week.
All right.
But my last nibble bit, The Witcher 3's Blood and Wine expansion has a release date of May 30th. It was originally rumored this week, and then they came out and confirmed it along with a trailer. So we were talking a little bit about Blood and Wine in the chat. Kind of makes me want to get back into The Witcher before that DLC comes out. Apparently it's awesome.
You have to actually play The Witcher before you can do the DLC.
I know. Do you have to play the whole thing?
I don't know. I'm not sure where it starts. I would love to play I've got to get the season pass. I'd love to play those.
Yeah.
I haven't played any of the expansions for it. I've all heard they're all pretty good.
Gotta be better than the Fallout 4 expansions.
When's the Harbor one supposed to come out?
19th.
Okay. Cool. All right. I will go next with the bits. You don't have anything else, right, Corey?
No, that's it.
Okay. NVIDIA has announced its new lineup of 1000 series graphics cards with the GTX 1080 and GTX 1070. The 1080 will retail for $600 and is more powerful and more powerful than and three times as energy efficient as the $1,000 Titan X. It's apparently more powerful than two 980s in SLI. That will be available May 27th. And then they also, like I said, announced the 1070, which is the one I'm interested in, will be available in June for $380. So, yeah, apparently these are really, really big power upgrades, and the energy efficiency of these things is incredible. They had they showed a chart, and one 1080 uses less power, I think, than the 960, which is a few steps down from the 1080. So
that means cheaper 900 series, yeah.
Not as much as you'd think.
What?
Yeah, I was talking to one of my friends about it. He's got two 980 Ti's in his computer, and he was hopefully looking for a discount. He just offloaded. He had 970s in his computer initially, upgraded to two 980 Ti's, and he's glad he offloaded his 970s before they made this announcement. I think the 970s now are still going for like $300.
Ugh.
They should be steeply discounted at this. No one's going to buy a 980 or 970 or 980 Ti at this point, you know?
I was really looking to get a new video card.
Yeah, I would wait. Eric is interested in upgrading his too, and I told him to wait till the 1060 comes out, which will probably be later this summer. It'll probably be mid to low 200s price-wise, if I had to guess. And he wouldn't, because he had expressed concern about his power supply being powerful enough. And he's got the GTX 760 in his computer now, so it would use less power than that even. So he wouldn't have to worry about power supply upgrade, just plop in the new graphics card. But good stuff. I'm excited.
So
giddy when I saw that announcement.
These cards are like way better than the last ones.
Well, yeah, like I said, the one 1080 is more powerful than two 980s in SLI and more powerful than the Titan X.
So if I got two of them, holy crap.
Yeah, if you got two 1080s, you'd probably be good for...
Ever?
Eh, not ever, but probably anything in 1080p, 1440p, or even 4K resolution probably would last you for a little while.
Now, how much are these again?
The 1080 600.
I can do that.
Two $600 graphics cards.
Yeah, let's pop them in.
Well, I don't think your motherboard can have two cards.
We know a lot about my motherboard because I already fried one.
Yep. I'm pretty sure it's not SLI compatible. I'd have to look at it again, but.
All right, so another 200 for a motherboard, right?
No.
80.
Well, you might. I would have to see what kind of processor you have, because I know my processor at this point is too old for a new motherboard. I would have to spend a lot to get an old motherboard to work with my i7 2600. So when I upgrade my motherboard, it's going to be also processor upgrade.
So basically, when you want to upgrade your card, you're like, oh, I have to upgrade these other four components.
No, if you just wanted to plop in a new 1080, it would be just fine.
Okay.
If you wanted to add two, I would have to check and see if your motherboard is SLI compatible. I'm not sure if it is or not.
Yeah, give it the old try.
Sure. But yeah, I mean, my computer's 4 years old at this point. So, it's 3 or 4. Well, I mean, I guess it was manufactured 4 years ago. So, I can't really find motherboards anymore that aren't overpriced.
Yeah.
So. So there's that. There's my graphics card news. And then, also big news today, 2K Games announced Civilization VI, which we could have covered today with it being a C. Coming later this year in October, the biggest change that I've noticed so far is it seems that cities will now take up multiple tiles, allowing the player more specialization in their cities. There's not a lot of other details that I've come across yet, but that's a buy for me in October, no question.
Huh.
Civ 6.
I'm pretty pumped for it, too.
Cities kind of did take up multiple tiles in the past, right?
It was only technically one tile, like it would spill over onto the other tiles, but it only, quote-unquote, took up one tile.
But the city still worked surrounding tiles, you know?
Yeah, yeah, but that's the, I mean, I guess it's, you have multiple tiles actually, like, in your city. Yeah, the neighboring tiles were worked by citizens of the city, but it wasn't technically the city. So, Civ 6.
Huh. We'll talk about grand strategy.
We will. Oh, yeah, because you're going to be talking about this.
Yeah.
All right. All right, Will, nibble bits.
My first one is that Pokemon Sun and Moon got a release date of November 18th. And with the announcement, they showed off the three new starters. The first one is Rowlet, who is a grass-flying owl-type Pokemon. Then there's Litten, which is a fire-type kitten-looking thing. And then there's the water-type Popplio, who is a seal. And a lot of people are hating on Popplio on the internet, and I don't really know why.
Hate Popplio. I'm not sure why either. I thought he looked fine.
Yeah, like the first evolutions are supposed to be like cute or doofy looking. The middle ones are supposed to be awkward, and then the final ones are supposed to be awesome.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I kind of feel bad because it's funny because I was looking at him. I'm like, I kind of like Popplio the most. So, and it turns out that's the one everybody hates.
Yeah. And everybody. I just can't picture, and maybe it's because I'm in my 30s, looking at the three part starting Pokemon and being like, what? Awful. Like, I don't know. Just can't picture that.
No, Dan, that's a very valid point. If we want to make fun of anything here with creativity, Litten.
Yeah, like, the name's not great. I'll
Litten?
Give you. I'm not going to lose sleep over it. That's for sure.
There's only so many Pokemon names out there.
Yeah.
That's true. They're knocking on, what, 800-900 different Pokemon?
I mean, last generation, they had a Chandelure as a Pokemon.
Like, yeah.
Cool.
There were some bad ones in the last Pokemon, Pokemon X and Y.
Wait, so these are fully new Pokemon games, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Now,
Pokemans.
Now, wait, Dan, are you getting one of them?
We'll have to see.
Okay.
We'll have to see my situation financially when the time comes.
Gotcha.
I would love to have it.
Because I got to figure out how I'm going to get all three Pokemon starters, because that's what I like to do.
It depends on what else is coming around it, too, you know? Fall is no doubt going to fill up over the next few months.
Yeah, another game just got announced. I think Eric tweeted, so I'm going to cover it.
Okay.
Let me check the stuff in November. So far, the only thing in November, actually two things, is Call of Duty and Dishonored 2, which I know you're not getting Call of Duty.
Battlefield 1.
Let me get into that, Dan. It's coming out October 21st, same day as Civ 6.
Oh, jeez. That sucks.
Now, Battlefield 1, let me tell you, it takes place in World War 1, and this game looks amazing.
Yeah.
Did any of you watch the trailer where the guy broke down everything?
Yeah.
I tweeted it.
Oh, no.
Did you tweet it?
Yeah. Flakfire Gaming.
Yep.
He was never heard of until this trailer breakdown.
Which he got over 1 million views on it, and I subscribed to him. And, like, his other videos had, like, 10,000 views.
Oh, yeah. No, not even. 200.
Yeah.
I looked at, like, the new Call of Duty one. It had, like, 200.
Yep. And I was going through him today, and, like, he had his Fallout ones got, like, maybe 4,000 people.
Hmm.
So, it's a very good breakdown. The guy knows a lot, so, like, he can tell you everything pretty much. And it just seems super... It's like a time period that, like, when people associate World War One, it's just trench warfare, which it wasn't just that. There's way more to it. And, like, I listened to Dan Carlin's Hardcore History, like, the 12 hours of it, of World War One. Yeah. So, like, I know a lot.
Yeah. What's Blueprint that? Armageddon.
Yep.
Listen to that. It's great stuff.
It's definitely worth the listen to. And if you're super interested and into the new Battlefield that's coming out, I definitely say you should try and listen to as much of the Blueprints of Armageddon as you can. But... do you guys have any interest in getting it?
Yeah.
I'm going to get it.
Even Corey has interest.
Absolutely, I do.
I don't know how much multiplayer I'll play, but I definitely want to play the campaign.
Now, have there been shooters that we know of that have been World War One? I know there are probably some out there.
There's one called Verdun.
Verdun?
Yeah. But other than that, like, I don't... it's not as popular as World War II, obviously, for first-person shooters.
I think there's a lot of opportunity there.
Oh, sure.
And I'm kind of fine with them taking like the liberties online to fit like their normal Battlefield mold. Like, as long as they stay fairly within the time period, like, I'm fine with attachments and, like, weapons and stuff like that.
Bayonets. That's...
Yeah, bayonets, bipods, even, like, a silencer. I don't care. Like, whatever.
There's going to be horses, right? We saw horses in the trailer.
Horses? Which was... I saw a horse running alongside the tank, and I'm like, I am sold immediately.
Hell there was horses in World War II, also. Yep. Not as much as World War I, but...
Yeah, no, so... And it's funny that... I was on, like, Reddit, and some people were kind of hating on the Battlefield 1 trailer, but that's Reddit. They complain about everything all the time.
Yep.
But, like, looking at the YouTube, I think it has over a million likes and not as many dislikes, which is funny. That's coming off of Infinite Warfare that was heavily disliked.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I just think the Battlefield fan base feels like they have something to prove to the Call of Duty fan base, so... Just a war of likes that means absolutely nothing. So,
In Ratcast says bolt action won't work. Need more than that. The trailer shows off there are automatic weapons, too. So,
but I think bolt action could work too. You know, it's all about the visceral feel of the gun. If you're firing that gun and you're feeling it and you're popping off headshots with it,
mm-hmm.
regardless of whether it's an automatic or bolt action. Still going to feel good, and you're still going to feel rewarded for it. I agree, like, the current modern warfare games with the submachine, semi-automatic, automatic weapons, like, strafing back and forth. I mean, if that's a lot of fun to you and that's what you really like, then maybe Battlefield 1 is not for you.
Yeah.
But I do feel like there is room for both, and I think, you know...
I mean...
I always preferred the carbine-type guns in these games anyway. The mid-range, like... 6 or 8 shot carbine rifles were always
my favorite.
So,
like, even in like World at War, when I played that a lot, like my favorite weapon was like the bolt action snipers, like just without a scope, just like moving around trying to pop off some like headshots here and there on the map and being a mobile sniper. Like, I had a lot of fun doing that, and I'm more than fine with a ton of bolt action.
Yeah.
It's just I in the trailer we just saw so much, like the guy sitting in the turret in the plane. And fire, like, that's just, I don't know, I think that'll be so much fun. And I think it does kind of open up more opportunity for interesting gameplay things, because you're not just running up to somebody with a submachine gun, strafing back and forth, and trying to kill them before they kill you.
Mm-hmm.
There's probably a little bit more that goes into it.
And this is going to be, like, another thing, this is a setting and time period that I would say most people just haven't even seen in a game yet.
Yeah.
So, what like,
talking about Valiant Hearts.
I was just going to say the only other World War One game was Valiant Hearts, but like that, the gameplay is going to be so completely different.
That's another thing, too, is I was really hating on Valiant Hearts, but it was because I had just listened to the Dan Carlin.
Which is super dark.
Blueprints for Armageddon, and yeah, he talks about just how horrible and awful those battles were, and then to go and play like what amounted to essentially was a cartoon version of World War One, like, it immediately turned me off. Like, I felt like it just trivialized all the violence and stuff. And the way, like, oh, you got blown up by a grenade, you just respawn and try again. I don't know. It just... And I don't know if I'm going to have the same issue with Battlefield 1.
I mean, I don't know how the campaign will be. I don't know. Did you like playing Battlefield Online at all?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I've always enjoyed playing the Battlefield. I like vehicles, man. That's just always been...
So, I mean, I don't think you'll think it'll, like, trivialize the game. I really don't think that, because the Battlefields are pretty good at being kind of, like, brutal and whatnot. The campaign, I don't know how that'll work. I can't imagine it'll be, I don't know, like, not poke fun, but, like, not be... It'll show the horrors, is my guess, because they were showing off mustard gas and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And that was a very horrible thing that happened in World War One. So I could imagine, like, I think they'll get into all of that.
I'm also totally okay with trench warfare. I would just sit in a trench for 2 hours if I could and play, like, multiplayer trench warfare. I think that would be so much fun. Just, like, waiting for your shot forever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I don't know. That's just me.
Which I can see Corey just in the trench while we're all playing online, just trying to pop out with a shot every now and again.
Just smoking a cigar, just waiting.
If it were me, I'd want to be, you know, in a tent somewhere playing in the strategy away from the danger.
And Beardless 2 also brings up a good point. Don't all war games trivialize the horror of war?
Well, yeah, I mean, that was kind of my point, because I had just listened to the Blueprint for Armageddon. You know, I felt really close to the horrors of that war, and that's why Valiant Hearts didn't do it for me.
Yeah. Sure.
And I guess I probably shouldn't listen to that again before I play Battlefield 1.
I think it'll be completely different, because Valiant Hearts was like a cartoony... like platformer, like this is at least a shooter.
Yeah. Yeah, but I still people are running around worried about their KD, and all I can think about is how many civilians died in
any
specific path. You know, I don't know.
It's gonna be interesting to see how this works. I'm guessing we're gonna see a lot at E3 of this game, because they did kind of show off a lot.
Yeah. I'm excited.
So EA's press conference, we're going to get Mass Effect, Andromeda, and Battlefield 1.
Mass Effect got delayed again.
Yeah, but they also said that they're going to show off a lot of stuff at E3, or show off more, or something like that. More than a teaser.
That's good.
Like last year. I guess then my last nibble bit is that Heroes of the Storm is getting some changes to the game, mainly to the ranked play. I know this won't mean anything to you guys, but for some of the people who really... I still play Heroes of the Storm, so it's kind of interesting to me. But the players will rise their ranks like normal, but there will be different tiers for them. Like, there's bronze, silver, diamond, gold, all those, which I think they're in other MOBAs too, which is cool. And, like, you get rewards for rising through the ranks and getting different different tiers. Like, you'll get gold, you'll get mounts, you'll get... I think those are the only two things that I saw. And also, they announced the next two heroes, which is going to be Chromie, who is a little gnome hero from the Warcraft universe, and she's like a time mage sort of thing, who looks really awesome. She's an assassin. And then there is Medivh, who is a specialist, which only has like one attack, but is... To be honest with you, I don't really know how Medivh plays. Only has one attack, but I think he's going to be really good at giving support to the other heroes on the battlefield. I know a lot of people on the Heroes of the Storm subreddit was talking about how Medivh is broken without having even played him.
Medivh OP?
Yeah, that's, I guess, the consensus, which nobody has any idea. Because everybody complains about the new hero being overpowered the first week because nobody knows how to play him.
Right.
Or play against the hero, and then slowly, like, if it's overpowered, then Blizzard will nerf it. But
who's going to be the second Overwatch hero in Heroes of the Storm?
Funny you mentioned that, Dan. It's not a next Overwatch hero, but Nova's getting a Widowmaker skin.
Oh.
Which kind of sucks, because I kind of wanted Widowmaker in there, but the next Overwatch hero, who besides Tracer, who else would you say is, like, would encapsulate Overwatch?
Winston.
I would be fine with Winston. That would be pretty awesome.
Dr. Va? No, we know the answer to that. It's Bastion.
Bastion.
We'll get into talking about Bastion later. Sure. I'd be fine with, because maybe Mercy, because like they need a support. The heroes need more support heroes. Lucio would be pretty cool.
I think Lucio would be good. Like a quick healer that just did area of effect healing.
Yeah.
And increases movement speed.
Yeah.
I could see people being really upset and saying that it's overpowered, but it would be interesting at least.
Yeah.
But other than that, that's it for my nibble bits.
Cool. How was your week, Will?
It's good. I'm finishing up school, which I'm really excited because this semester really dragged on. For me, felt like it was like a 7th month semester as opposed to like 3, and which is funny because it's my easiest semester that I've had. Like, I'm signed up for 19 credits next fall, so that one's gonna be way harder, but I'm hoping it goes way faster.
That's what I always said, Will. My most difficult semester was my last semester, which was 12 credits, which is the minimum you can take and be full time, and I planned it that way, so I had an easy last semester, and it was by far my most difficult.
Yep.
And I had taken, I think 17 was my biggest semester. And
You were fine with that,
yep,
right?
The 12 credit one was by far the hardest.
It's funny, a person in my English class was talking about how he only has 12 credits, and he's like, man, this was the hardest semester I've had.
I wonder if it's just because you're, like, you're constantly back and forth between, like, doing nothing and then having to do something, versus when you're taking more credits, you're, like, constantly doing something, so you're always on.
Definitely. And, like, now I only have, like, English and biology to go to, so, like, just like one class a day, and it's just like I don't want to go.
So you're just miserable the entire day because of that one class.
Yeah, and like my English is really, really interesting, but it's an hour and 15 minutes, and I'm just like completely zoned out, and I'm just disinterested.
Snooze fest.
Yeah. If I didn't like the teacher so much, I'd just like not go.
What's the English class?
It's English 220, communicating about values.
Ideas and values.
Which it's funny because we're learning about Buddhism in it. And, like, reading this, like, Buddhist text about some philosopher, and, like, Nagarjuna is his name. And it's just, like, we're learning all these Buddhist ideas because the guy, like, is a Buddhist or whatever. And it's, like, super interesting, but it's, like, really hard to, like, learn all of it because I'm so used to, like, I don't know, Western thinking, I guess.
Christianity.
Yeah. And it's, like, I'm definitely not becoming a Buddhist, but it is a little interesting to learn about it. And our final project is we have to do a 5-page paper on wisdom, like a guide to wisdom.
I like it.
And I literally have no idea like what I'm going to do, but I kind of have an idea, but
I was in the presence of His Holiness the Dalai Lama.
He brings up the Dalai Lama.
Yeah.
Actually, he just the other day, he was talking about how because Buddhists don't have any sense of self, they're explaining low self-esteem to Dalai Lama. And he just said he was blown away by that.
Yeah. It's like self-esteem. What? No.
Exactly.
You don't. Like, no. You're selfless.
Self-esteem is a big thing here in America.
Sure is.
Yeah. And he said it like it was a big like atmosphere full of people. And he asked like how many of you like have this in like. 80% of the people raised their hand, and he was like, oh my god, this is crazy.
This is blowing my mind.
Yeah. And so, like, it's cool to learn about, like, all that stuff, and I find it really interesting, and I really like the teacher. He's like this, as soon as I saw him, I was like, oh, as soon as he said, I want everybody to put the chairs in a circle, I was like, I know what kind of guy this is. And I look up, and he's, like, in a flannel, tight pants, long gray hair, and a ponytail.
Is he Buddhist?
Yeah, he is. He meditates and all that. But
nice.
Really like the class. I am excited to be done with it so I don't have to worry about school anymore. I guess hockey we can talk about. I don't know. Dan?
Yeah.
You can take it because your team's the only one that's still playing.
Game 7 tomorrow.
I cannot wait to watch it. You think they're going to play better than they did last game in San Jose?
My only hope is that they don't go in and lay an egg like they did game 5. You know, if they ultimately end up losing, like, I'll be happy with what they did so far. As long as it's a close game. Like, I don't want them to get killed like they did against San Jose in game 5.
Yeah.
In San Jose. So the positive thing we're looking at is that it's the first time since the playoffs have started that the Predators have gotten more than one day of rest in between games.
Yeah.
You know, San Jose had almost a week in between their series with LA and series with Nashville. Nashville finished up in Anaheim and went right to San Jose one day in between games.
Mm-hmm.
So hopefully that extra rest does them some good, and hopefully it's a good game.
It's funny because I listen to a lot of podcasts. By the way, listen to the Steve Dangle podcast. They talk about the names of the Western Hockey League players that just got drafted into the WHL.
I read that article, actually.
Oh, my God. Like, Timber.
Yeah, there's some
Steel
good ones.
Boomer. And they're just making fun of 15-year-old kids the whole time. But it's hilarious to listen to it. But they picked San Jose to win the series in, like, 4 or 5 games. And I'm like, are you kidding me?
Yeah.
I think the Nashville Predators are like the most underrated team in the NHL.
Sure, I think they like it that way though.
Oh, definitely. They've just got so many. Like, I would say they've got the best offensive like pairings in the league. I feel like Ellis and Ekholm could be like a top pairing on another team.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I really want Nashville to advance because I really think that they can go to the Cup if they advance.
I don't know, man. The the thing I always look at is Nashville is the fourth best team in the Central Division.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, who knows when we go up against one or two in the Central.
This is how I look at it, Dan. You also had a really bad year because Rene was pretty horrible for 80% of it.
Yeah, he's finally playing better. I was just glad that Arvidsson was the one to get the overtime goal.
Oh, yeah. That was beautiful.
He's played so hard all playoffs, and it was good to see him be the one to score the game winner in overtime.
The best part is he wasn't even looking when he shot the puck. He just kind of flung it on net, and it was just like the perfect location.
Yep. It's good stuff.
I mean, San Jose is considered an awful home team, so I'm kind of surprised Nashville hasn't won a game there yet.
They've never won a game against San Jose in San Jose in the playoffs.
Really?
Yep.
Maybe this is... I mean, at some point, that trend has to break, so...
Sure.
Maybe this is the time.
Hopefully.
But I'm really excited for you, Dan. I really hope that they pull it out.
Yeah. Thanks. Me too.
Yeah. Because they're the team I'm bandwagoning now, so...
That's all right. They don't have too many bandwagon fans, so...
No, it's funny because Johnny's brother Nick is a Capitals fan, and they just got eliminated last night. So I was like, hey, sorry, man, I was really rooting for them. And I was like, there's room on the Predator bandwagon if you want to join.
Have the Predators made it to the conference finals yet?
No, they've only made it as far as the second round.
Cool.
This is actually the first time, I think they had never played a game later than like May 9th. So already they're in the playoffs like at a later date than they've ever been. So this year was the first year they'd played in a game 7.
They played 2.
Yep, and they'll be playing 2. So
they also play a 3 overtime game, which was insane.
Yep.
Stuff. Yeah. That's all I got. Henrik Lundqvist to Dallas, please.
4.
All of the prospects.
Oh, all of them?
Yep.
Okay.
That's it for me. I don't really have anything else too interesting.
What do you got, Corey?
Quite a few things, actually. I'll try to get through it pretty quickly, but I wanted your guys' opinion on a lot of this stuff. I bought an HD antenna, a digital HD antenna, for my TV. I get 7 channels clear as day, which is pretty good.
Nice.
Considering it was only $30,
and
that's 7 channels for free forever. NBC being one of them, which was the big one for me. There's websites where you can look up like what kind of channels you'll get depending on the type of antenna you have and where you point it and stuff like that. And NBC was kind of a stretch because I think it was like 40 some miles away. So I had to buy a 50 mile antenna and get it in the right spot in the room. But it turns out I got it. I want it for hockey for when the games are on NBC. So that's good. CBS is another one. The CW, there's like a local channel, a couple other ones.
There's like 3 WSKGs or 2 WSKGs.
Something like that, yeah.
I'm sorry, PBS.
Yeah. I mean,
WSKGs are local PBS.
I hesitated a long time on this HD antenna thing because I knew as soon as I got it, my girlfriend would start watching a ton of really bad TV again. And at least when we didn't have that, she'd have to find something on Netflix.
Sure.
She's been watching like she's been binge watching shows. Like she's almost done with the X-Files.
Wow.
Like makes me so happy. I don't like the X-Files, but it makes me so happy that she's watching that and not the Kardashian, you know, whatever. I don't even know what channel the Kardashians is on, but like we were excited because Judge Judy was on today. Like that was the first thing we tuned into with our HD antenna. But the channels come in great, high def, clear as day. I haven't really explored to see like what channels might kind of come in enough to watch, but that the auto tuner didn't pick up on. So there might even be more. I don't know. That was just what the auto tuner picked up.
Yeah, I had an HD antenna for a couple of years before we finally got cable again on a deal. It works fine.
Yeah,
I was pretty happy with it. We had to move it on occasion. Because the way the antenna was, it was right behind my computer chair.
Mm.
So if I was sitting in my computer chair with the back up against the antenna, it would mess up the signal.
Yeah.
It was just the way the things were placed in our living room.
Yeah.
So like when my wife was watching Fallon at night, I would have to turn my chair so it was more straight so the antenna would have plenty of room to pick up the signal.
Yeah.
Or Fallon or Dancing with the Stars or The Bachelor, or this is the other show she watches. So.
Yeah, well, we're kind of lucky because we're high up on the second floor, and our TV room is all windows. It's just like a big sunroom, so
should be
we
good.
Don't have to worry about much interference there. I watched Deadpool. It's awesome.
I don't know if
you guys have seen Deadpool.
No, I've heard good things.
It's really good. I'm not huge comic book guy. I'm not big on the movies either. I just kind of enjoy them. I'm not a fanatic or anything like that. I think Deadpool is my favorite.
Nice.
I'm a big Ryan Reynolds fan. Which is kind of weird to say out loud now that I said it, but he makes a really, really
Boston.
Yeah. I'm not defending them. I think you know they're probably a bunch of assholes.
that did stupid things. It's the type of thing where
in the early mid 2000s, I think it was 2006, something like that.
Yes.
And it's funny how your memory is flavored by the media coverage of it. Because last I knew, they were all a bunch of skeezy assholes and were indicted or charged or whatever the phrase is and did some bad things. But it kind of turns out that that wasn't the case. And the woman who accused them of rape actually said they didn't rape me after a while. And the whole thing was just kind of blown. Yeah. I'm not defending them. I think you know they're probably a bunch of assholes.
that did stupid things. It's the type of thing where obviously the media doesn't always paint the whole picture.
Exactly.
You know, there's more to the story usually in anything.
Yeah.
You know.
And I'm not giving them a pass. I still think they were up to no good, and there could have been something, but it might not have been to the extent that the woman claimed it was, and she even said it wasn't.
Right.
And she was actually she's in jail for murder now. So
really?
Yeah, she is.
Dear God.
But there was one moment that really stood out to me in the whole 30 for 30 thing. And it's like an hour and a half. I didn't realize they were that long. It was really long. I thought it was 30 minutes. Isn't that what 30 for 30 means?
To be honest with you, I thought it had something to do with 30. Maybe not. I don't know.
I don't know. I guess it doesn't matter, but
I'm going to look it up because it's going to bother me.
Yeah, but a moment that really stood out to me, and this is what I was talking about with captain speeches, is when the captain, they found like DNA evidence under a fingernail in a garbage can or something like that of his. And he was the first of his teammates to come out in front of the media and just say, I am innocent of all charges. My teammates are innocent of all charges. And it was such, again, like I feel bad enjoying his speech because he might have done something real bad. I don't really know. But as far as like captain speeches go, for him to like walk up in front of the media as a 20-year-old kid or whatever and say what he said in front of all those people and stand up for his team, I was just beside myself. I'm like, what a great captain, you know? Like what a great captain thing to do.
Sure.
Thought that was really cool. But those 30 for 30s are pretty good. I still haven't seen the one of our local football team.
Yeah, I mean, adult football. No, I haven't watched it either.
Pop Murtha himself.
It's 30 different directors telling 30 different stories.
Oh. So 30 for 30 means?
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. Cool. The last thing I want to talk about, I listened to a bunch of new podcasts this week. Summer's in full swing, so I'm outside doing my thing, which means I can listen to as much podcast as I want. So I listened to a few. The first one I listened to was a film podcast, and the guy was talking. I'm like, I know this guy's voice. What is it from? And I finally realized it's Bald Brian.
Really?
On the Film Vault podcast.
Oh, I used to listen to that.
Yeah.
Is Anderson still on it? Is he still the other guy?
I think so, yeah, Anderson.
Yeah.
I didn't like it at all.
Yeah.
Wasn't into it at all. There's a couple of really good film podcasts I listened to, one of them being Film Spotting.
Uh-huh.
Which is a little bit more my speed. I couldn't really keep up with their, the back and forth between the two. Like I couldn't really keep up with that.
Okay.
Bald Brian is a funny guy.
Yeah.
And I was laughing out loud at some of the stuff he said, but as far as like the infotainment aspect, I just wasn't getting anything out of it.
Gotcha. Mm. Yeah. I listened to that for a little while when I was, cause I don't even really watch movies that much.
Yeah.
So it was just
And I didn't understand what their format was for their show. They were just talking about random stuff at the beginning, and it seemed like they knew what the format was, but I could not understand what was going on. So I wasn't big on that. But I also listened to Kind of Funny for the first time, the Greg Miller podcast, when he spun off from IGN with his cronies there. They have the Kind of Funny network, I guess. And I listened to the Kind of Funny Gamescast, which is pretty good. I forget, is it Tim Geddes that's on there with him? I can't remember. But that's a pretty good gaming podcast. Maybe not in my top 3 or 4, but probably top 5, top 10, definitely. Also listen to Ask Me Another, which is a trivia podcast out of NPR. That's a big nope for me. Didn't care for it. If you want good trivia from NPR, listen to Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me. It's their news trivia show they do every week with Peter Sagal. It's funny. It's some good stuff on there.
What if you hate the news?
You'd probably still enjoy it. There's some good humor. They have a panelist of comedians that are the contestants, and they
make fun of stuff.
Include civilians. Yeah. Yeah, they do.
Nice.
Listen to another one called Welcome to Night Vale, which is... I don't understand the I don't know what the genesis of it is, but it's like 4 years into it or something like that, and I think it's weekly. I can't remember. But it's this fictional world that was created, and it's just a series of... It's like a talking head, like... doing a public service announcement for the local children and talking about the news that's going on in this fictional town that this writer created that's kind of science fiction-y, weird stuff going on. He was talking about aliens, and I don't know. Like, I read the description because it was on one of the top-rated it was on the top-rated podcast list, and I read the description. It said, oh, start at the beginning or just jump in whenever, and it'll make total sense. It made absolutely no sense to me.
Of course it did.
The production values were good, but I don't know. I probably won't listen to it again. I didn't really get enough out of the lore to catch my interest, so. Huh? I understand the appeal, but... probably not for me at this point. And then I listened to 2 Game of Thrones podcasts.
Nice.
Which I'm hooked on. I subscribed. I'm going to listen to them every week. One of them I listened to was called Game of Thrones, the podcast. And that was the better of the two. And they do... Are you guys still there?
Yeah.
Does the video cut out?
Of course it did.
That's weird. The Game of Thrones, the podcast. And what they do after every episode, they do the instant take, which is their, like, 30 minutes, just immediate thoughts on the most recent show, and they do it right after the episode, so that's up, like, Sunday night. It's 2 guys, very knowledgeable. One of them's read all the books, knows all the lore, reads the wiki all the time. The other guy just watches the show, so it's good to have the 2 perspectives.
Yeah.
And then they do, like, on Tuesday, they do their main episode, which is, you know, they have time to process it. They think about it, they compare stuff, and then they come and talk about it. And then they do the spoiler cast even later in the week, and this is all based on a single episode. They do the spoiler cast, which is they bring in information from the books and talk about stuff that might be a spoiler. Although at this point, the show is a little bit ahead of the books. So, I mean, there still is some spoilery stuff because the show tends to jump back in the book timeline to pull stuff up.
Yeah, there was a good one. In this week's episode that was talked about in the very very beginning of the first book.
Yeah, was it which part was it?
That was the sword fight.
Oh, the Tower of Joy.
Yep.
Oh my god.
I know.
So good. Scene. Oh my god. So Arthur Dayne. I'm in
amazing.
Love. That whole part was amazing. We'll talk. We should talk Game of Thrones.
We should.
And then the other one's a cast of Kings. Not as good as the Game of Thrones podcast, but it has podcaster I really like. His name's David Chen. He does the Slash Film Cast, another film podcast that I listen to. And he also does the Tobolowsky Files with Stephen Tobolowsky, who's a relatively famous character actor. Ned Ryerson from Groundhog Day.
Uh-huh.
Is he Ned Ryerson? Ned Ryerson? Oh, he's the guy that says, "Watch your step, first step, it's a doozy."
Yeah, okay.
Remember that guy? Yeah, that's Stephen Tobolowsky. But the same type of thing, the woman on that, I forget her name, Vanessa, maybe is her name, has read all the books, knows all the backstory. David Chen is just a show watcher. So again, they have the dynamic of the two, and it's also really good. But of the two, I preferred the Game of Thrones podcast, but I've learned so much listening to those podcasts, just like keeping everybody's name straight and hearing the backstory and, I'm all in. Like, I'll read before we got ahead of the books. I refused to read anything about it because I didn't want any of it to be spoiled. But now that I know, like, in the timeline, we're a little bit ahead, I read the wikis. I don't mind any kind of book spoiler or anything like that. So it's good stuff. But yeah, a lot of podcasts I listen to. Actually, I had a chat question in the chat. What's your favorite podcast to listen to right now? That changes day by day, really.
Depending on what you're in the mood for.
Yeah, the Bombcast, Giant Bomb, is always a favorite, and the Beastcast is another favorite. I like the 8-4 Play podcast, which is a Japanese games podcast out of Japan. They're a localization company, and they do a bi-weekly video games podcast. Those are, you know, in my top three or whatever. Angry Chicken is a Hearthstone podcast I listen to regularly. I'm just trying to see what I have here. It's hard picking a favorite, like Merrick versus Wyszynski for hockey. There's three type of podcasts I subscribe to. It's video games, hockey, and like
film.
Film, yeah, I guess. And the fourth would be like tech. I listened to This Week in Tech with Leo Laporte. Radio Lab's a good one.
Yeah.
I don't know. I listened to Kotaku Split Screen. I listened to IGN's podcast, Nintendo Voice Chat, Podcast Beyond. I subscribe to The Art of Manliness, but I haven't listened to that yet. So there's a bunch. I listen to a bunch of podcasts, but it's hard to pick a favorite. I would say maybe Thumbstick Athletes would be my favorite.
Probably, yeah.
So there's that.
Yeah, if I had to pick.
I don't know.
Have you given Smartest Man in the World a listen yet?
No, who's that?
That's, I think I told you about it a couple weeks ago. It's, frick, what's his name?
I'll put it on right now.
You don't have to. It's God damn it, Greg. He was on
Greg Proops.
Greg Proops, yeah. That was always one of my favorites because he does them all live. He kind of riffs on the news. Really smart guy, you know, smartest man in the world. But he also loves baseball, so it's kind of interesting to hear him talk about old baseball.
Yeah. Good stuff. It's kind of like I've listened to a ton of podcasts, and I find myself trying to determine like what makes a good podcast.
Yeah,
and like I talked about the Film Vault one, like they're funny guys, but it just didn't come together in an interesting kind of way. It's like you need a bunch of different things. You need like chemistry, a little bit of humor, and enough like information to keep you engaged. I don't know.
Yeah.
There's like a formula that isn't determined yet for like what makes a good podcast.
I don't think there ever will be one either, because I think the format lends itself to a niche listening audience.
And that's what it, you try to be too broad.
Yeah.
You're sunk.
Sure.
I don't know. We should do a podcast about podcasts.
We could do that.
It'd be fun to do. There's that guy that does the Zero Feedback website for video games that are released but have zero critical write-ups on them.
Mm-hmm.
It'd be fun to do that for podcasts.
Yeah.
You know, find a podcast that nobody has ever reviewed. Play clips from it and criticize it.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else, Corey?
No.
I don't really have anything else going on either. Yeah, so we'll take a quick break and be back with what we played and feedback in just a moment. I got to run up and check on the kids.
Yeah, I got to pee and feed Fiona. Are you hungry? Yeah, she's hungry.
Oh, yeah. She knows it's time to eat. All right, be right back.
Is that you, Dan?
Huh?
Hi, Dan.
Hey.
Blizzard put out a response in dealing with Bastion in Overwatch.
Oh?
They said, try countering Bastion as Hanzo, Genji, Widowmaker, Roadhog.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I didn't like playing against Bastion, but I never had a super hard time. Like, usually it was if I got killed by him, it's because I walked into it.
Yeah, same here.
Hanzo, on the other hand.
Dan just couldn't counter Hanzo.
Oh my god. 9 times out of 10 in a match, I was killed by Hanzo. Doesn't matter who was playing Hanzo. It's brutal.
Why? Okay, I have a stream of the Stars Blues game going. Why is it showing soccer?
Oh, wow. St. Louis is up 3-0.
Yeah, they're killing them. But the lovely part about Dallas is that they can score 3 goals.
Yep.
In 2 minutes.
And as we know from last night's game, 3-0 lead can easily be erased.
Especially when you take 3 delay games in 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Bunch of idiots.
Gam! God. Such a big mouth.
Gimli, it's okay, man.
I mean, usually I don't go upstairs on a break for that reason.
Is Mom still there?
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah, Belle's not going to get home for probably another hour, at least.
Where's she at?
She went to Ticonderoga for an interview.
Oh, wow. Is that upstate more?
Oh, yeah. It's almost to Plattsburgh.
I'm going to look it up on a map.
It's far. It's 3 hours and 45 minutes away.
Holy crap. Okay. How close is it to the Canadian border?
I don't know. Probably an hour and a half. I'm not really sure. I know it's near the southern tip of Lake Champlain. It's right on Lake George.
Okay, wow. It's pretty close to Montreal, actually.
Yeah.
Cool. So is this for superintendent, or not superintendent, principal?
Yep. Yeah, she's got one there today, and then one, 2 hours and 15 minutes away tomorrow. So we may be moving.
Is Ticonderoga a nice place?
Yeah.
A nice area?
Yep.
Because these pictures, that looks really nice.
Yeah. There's Fort Ticonderoga there from the Revolutionary War.
Gotcha. Oh, wow.
Touristy spot. So the Endwell studio may be shuttered.
That's the mainstay.
Yeah. The place she's going tomorrow for an interview, they have, nearby where we live, has Verizon Fios internet.
What? So
they have the standard 50 down, 50 up, but they also have a fiber plan, which is 500 down, 500 up.
So wait, what's this place?
It's outside Schenectady.
Okay. Could you imagine? You would be in heaven.
I would be happy with the 50 down, 50 up, but the 500 down, 500 up would be amazing. That's expensive, though. I think it's over $200 a month.
I mean, do you not do cable, right?
Do you do cable? We have cable now, but just because I got a quote-unquote new customer deal, even though I've been with Time Warner for 10 years or whatever.
Huh. I'm jealous. These are looking nice.
It's just places. A possibility.
You never know. Did she hear back from Windsor?
Nothing from Windsor.
Gotcha.
I'm letting my beard grow too for the playoffs. It's fairly thick.
Yeah, it's looking thick. I was lucky I got to shave mine in a week.
I still can't grow any right here.
And then doesn't look bad though. I think you can grow the best beard out of all the Murphys.
Right down the middle. That doesn't really.
Oh yeah, I do see it.
The only reason is because I've been trying to grow one for like 5 or 6 years.
I never noticed that before.
What's that? The patch?
Yeah, the patch, because the delay on the camera.
Yep.
That's great.
Yeah, Dad's only ever grown like a little goatee down here.
Yeah, he's never grown anything.
A couple times. I just never like shaving. That's why I decided to, like, once I could, grow a beard.
Well, it's kind of a pain having to do it every couple of days.
Yeah. I never cared for it.
Okay, why is it still soccer?
Is it in between periods?
No. Why the top comment is, why is this suddenly soccer?
It's the work of a troll.
Game back on, still soccer. Somebody said he had a hissy fit. I hate having to do this to watch the stupid games.
Yeah. That thing that Corey told me about, the VLC thing, worked pretty well.
I forgot how to do that, actually.
It's a program that you download that launches a stream in VLC. I had to do that when they put the Predators games on NHL Network.
Which is ridiculous.
Oh my god. Don't get me started.
Is this a stream? Adblock is enabled. Thanks. Ads are necessary to keep the site free. I don't want to take off Adblock.
No, I wouldn't. They all say that. I actually didn't. I don't use Adblock that much, but lately with the full screen pop up video ads where the volume is super loud.
And with like 9 different X buttons, so if you click the wrong one, I'm get a like, virus.
Well, I don't even mean for those. I mean on the gaming sites I regularly visit. I'm like, I'm not doing this anymore. This is ridiculous.
Like, I get why ads are important, but
yeah. Oh sure, but they're getting out of control too.
Yeah. This is why I want cable.
Yeah. There he is.
There we go.
Wow, the Dalai Lama has been playing this whole time.
Lama. I was watching it while you guys were talking about like all the different podcasts, and I was like, the Dalai Lama is still going.
Nothing wrong with that.
Dalai Lama.
No complaints.
I wonder if I still have the little prayer card from the Dalai Lama.
Which prayer is it?
It's just the whatever, the number, the something path. Is it the Tenfold Path or something like that?
Could be.
Whatever the Buddhist principles are.
Four Noble Truths?
Four Noble Truths? Maybe. I can't remember. I used to carry it in my wallet. But it's all stuff that makes total sense. You know, it's not religious stuff. It's more philosophical.
Sure. Yeah, no, a lot of the stuff with that he talks about, I'm like, that makes complete sense to me. And then some of it, I'm like, this is insane.
That's with anything, though, you know? Some of it makes sense and some of it's completely nuts.
Once I learned that everything is emptiness, it's like, whoa.
Why even live? You know,
it kind of gives you that. They're like, why am I here then?
Hey, there's no deeper question than that.
Why am I here?
Yeah. So I liked, what's his name? Black Science guy.
Neil deGrasse Tyson.
I just like to call him Black Science guy. There's a subreddit called Black Science guy.
Yeah.
So funny. I love his, description. Somebody, I forget what he was on, and he was interviewed, and somebody asked him about, like, smoking weed or something like that, and then going into a planetarium. I think that was the question, and he said something along the lines of the euphoria he feels when he steps outside and looks into the night sky is better than any drug induced
stupor.
Yeah. Reaction to something. Nice. And I'm kind of with him on that, you know?
Yeah.
The thing I like about Neil deGrasse Tyson is his ability to communicate, you know? Mm-hmm. That's something that's kind of lacking with heavily scientific people. That's why Carl Sagan was so popular too, because he kind of did the same thing.
He's yep.
A, you know, relatable guy, interesting guy.
If you want that that feeling of euphoria, listen to the Carl Sagan Pale Blue Dot speech from the end.
It's great.
The remastered version from the end of Cosmos is it's incredible.
Yep. Agreed. Okay, shall we get started?
Sure.
All right, here we go. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Welcome back, everybody. Episode 251 of the Thumbstick Athletes podcast. We are now in what we played. So I'm going to get this out of the way. I beat Dark Souls 3.
Yeah.
Thank you. I was gonna play Overwatch. It was what, Friday or Saturday night last. I think all you guys were playing Overwatch, but I was like, you know what? I'll play Dark Souls. I'm close to the end. I didn't know how close. Apparently, I was a lot closer than I thought. So I took a few stabs at the final boss, and I was like, man, this is not going to be easy. But it turns out I just had crappy partners helping me. Once I got two helpful partners, we pretty much wiped the floor with the final boss, and he ended up not being too difficult. So,
I had a much easier time with the last guy than the bosses leading up to him.
Yeah. I didn't have too much trouble I can't really think of a boss I had like a huge amount of trouble with. Probably the Pontiff.
Sulevan or whatever. Sulevan.
He's the one I had the most trouble with. I probably took 10 or 12 tries with him.
Really?
All the others I didn't have too much of an issue with.
See, I didn't have an issue until the Dancer.
Oh, the Dancer was kind of hard, yeah.
Every time she grabbed me, I wanted to throw my keyboard out the window.
Yeah, because that's a one-hit, one-kill grab. Yeah. I had a blast with Dark Souls. I'm like Corey, I immediately started the new game plus and played it for a little while. You know, I just blazed through the starting area. You're way over leveled, even a new game plus for the starting area again. So
but it's...
I took down the Iondex Gundyre thing, you know, first try. I think I got hit once. Yeah, that was pretty easy. But then I fired up Dark Souls 1 again and started playing that.
All right. We should discuss how we're going to go about our playthrough.
Yeah, because I figured I would play it a little bit and get a feel for it again, because it's been a while since I played that. I think the last time I played Dark Souls 1 was after I beat Dark Souls 2. And I played, and I got to a point where I just couldn't advance anymore. But I've since far surpassed that one spot and have done quite a bit on Dark Souls 1. I rang the first bell.
Yeah, on the roof.
On the roof.
Oh, you know what? I did that too.
Roof of the cathedral. I pretty much cleared out all the spots that you can go up. I beat the moonlight butterfly boss.
I don't think I've done that one yet.
Okay, that was in where you go through that foggy area with the trees, the tree guys with the whips.
Hell yeah.
That part was a pain. I killed the Hydra that was over there too.
The one that's throwing fireballs at you?
Yeah. Killed the Hydra.
I don't think I ever did that.
I've pretty much cleared out that part. I need to go into the dungeons now.
Did you do the texture mods and all that stuff?
Yes, I did all that stuff. It does affect gameplay a little bit, apparently.
Really?
I did the DS fix.
Yep.
Update, which does textures and all that stuff. It also updates it to 60 frames per second. That apparently affects your roll, and it affects your jump.
Mm.
Not enough to make it so you can't beat the game, but it definitely slows down the roll a little bit. So
I didn't know that.
If you're a Dodger, just because it messes with the physics, changing it from locked 30 to locked 60 frames per second. So I had to tinker with it a little bit because I was getting a lot of tearing. So I had to enable VSync in my NVIDIA settings for that specific game. Because apparently VSync or anti-aliasing causes crashes? But yeah, I had to enable the VSync through the NVIDIA graphics manager specifically for Dark Souls to get it to work. So it did require some tinkering, but it works great now, runs great. It's a hard game.
Let me ask you the comparison to Dark Souls 3, comparing and contrasting. Do you have a preference? Do you feel one stands out above the other?
I mean, I like the newer games because the gameplay I feel like is more tight.
Okay.
It's quite a bit more jank in the first one than in 2 and 3. They're definitely refined gameplay wise. The AI is not as good in 1 as it is in 2 and 3.
That's true.
There's a lot of enemies you could get, like those crystal guys that are right outside where the Hydra is. Uh-huh. If you shoot them with arrows, you can lead them into like a cul-de-sac and they just keep running at you and you just keep shooting them with the bow. So there's a lot more of those type of things that you could take advantage of in Dark Souls 1 than there was in 2 and 3. I feel like the enemies aren't nearly as smart. But at the same time, like it feels like a little more foreboding and dangerous and scary than the other games because of the way... at least at this point, I haven't gotten any fast travel. So anything is a long walk. It's a long slog. There's always that chance that something's going to pop out and kill you, or that one enemy that you've killed 100 times is going to get you this one time, you know?
I don't believe there is fast travel in the first one.
I've heard you can get it later on. There's a not fast travel in the way that it's in Dark Souls 2 and 3, but there is a way to fast travel. Apparently. That could be completely wrong. I don't know. There's the Homeward Bones that you can use.
Right.
But that's in 2 and 3 too. So, but yeah, I'm really having a good time. Me and Corey are going to do some co-op. We'll have to try and get kind of in the same place, I think.
I'll catch up to you.
Are you behind me?
I think. I only rang the first bell. I think that was the last thing I did.
Okay. Yeah, there's a couple other bosses that you have to kind of dig deep to get in that area. So, but yeah, good stuff.
It is. It is a great game, and I love your adjective of foreboding.
Yeah.
I think that's a good way to describe it.
Yep.
It definitely felt like playing through it,
it's more scary.
As part of that, I felt like it was more rewarding too.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, I've had to solo all the bosses I've fought so far cuz I don't know if I'm not far enough to the point where anyone has any summon stuff down, but there's no...
Well, you gotta be human.
No, I know. Oh. I know. I know. I know. I know how it works.
Go to the Wikia. There. People are always in the chat there, and just ask, and somebody will help you.
Okay.
They have a really good, dedicated community.
If I run into trouble, I'll have to do that. I had some trouble with the gargoyles up on the roof.
Yeah. Took
probably 4 or 5 tries before I could beat them, but I ended up beating them, and I think I've killed like 3 or 4 bosses so far. One of them was a really janky boss fight. It was with that demon. It's kind of on the lower level of the Undead Burg. You go through it's a roundabout way, but it's a small room that you fight this demon in, and there's 2 like dogs. But I just went up onto a ledge, and I was able to just shoot him with arrows until he died.
Huh.
Yeah.
I don't remember that one.
Yeah. But good stuff.
Murky. Great stuff.
Yeah. So I played Dark Souls 1, and then Overwatch. You want to talk about Overwatch?
Let's talk about Overwatch. Yeah. I kind of wish Eric was here for this, but...
Sure. Yeah, I mean, I played quite a bit of Overwatch last week. I probably stopped this weekend. They extended the open beta another 24 hours. But I think one of my favorite my goal for the beta was to get used to one character of every like archetype, you know. I wanted to get good at like an assault, defense, tank, and support. And the last one I needed was support. So I tried. I was on a team that needed a healer, and no one wanted to be the healer. So I tried Mercy because I know Mercy's like a good healer, but I was just having no luck whatsoever. So I was only vaguely familiar with Lucio's abilities. I knew that he had area of effect healing. But I ended up jumping in, playing a game as Lucio, and dominating. Dominating. I really ended up loving his abilities, and I had a lot of people compliment me on how good of a Lucio I played, which was nice for me because I'm not really a first-person shooter player.
There must be something to that, Dan, because I had quite a bit of success as Lucio as well.
Once you learn his abilities, like, he's amazing.
Yeah.
Especially for anything where you have to capture like a point, mm-hmm. or if you can keep your team around a payload that you're escorting. His abilities are great because for those that don't know, he's an area of effect healer, and he has two settings. He can area of effect heal, or he can increase movement speed, and you change that with the left shift. Mm-hmm. And then his E ability is quote unquote turn up the volume or something like that, where it increases his effectiveness of either movement buff or his healing. So you know, if you're in combat or whatever, you just hit that and that'll increase the healing and keep people alive. And he shoots like a normal gun, so you can focus on the combat and not have to, you know, as long as you're kind of near your teammates, you're healing them.
Yep.
Which is what I liked about him over Mercy. You have to focus on healing while trying to kind of stay out of the combat, because she's like, she can't fight and heal at the same time, which I didn't like as much about her. And then his Q ability is, or his ultimate is shields. So, you know, if you're, again, in a combat-heavy situation, you hit those shields and
protect. Gives you, like, twice the health.
Yeah.
Temporarily.
For quite a bit. And then his right mouse click attack is like it's a sound blast that, you know, blasts enemies away from you if you're getting melee'd or whatever.
It's really nice because you can push them off ledges into holes.
Yep. Yep. I had a few games where I was super effective as Lucio and carried my team to victory. A couple plays of the game, a lot of compliments from my teammates. So that was nice.
Yeah. Speaking of Lucio, he kind of saved my opinion of the game for me.
Oh, okay.
I was having zero fun with Overwatch, honestly, and I tried a number of different characters. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't until Lucio, and I think part of the issue is the character of Lucio fixed a lot of things I didn't like about the game. Mm-hmm. One of them being survivability. Of mm-hmm. which there is almost none. Mm-hmm. And with Lucio's heal and his movement song, whichever one you're using, increases your survivability a little bit, whether it be like skating around really fast so the enemies can't really hit you, which I use to my advantage. Like if I use it sort of as a distraction, I go past enemy lines and then use the boost, the amp boost or whatever, to the song, which make you go even faster. And so you go behind him and everybody would turn around while your teammates could kind of advance a little bit and get in position. So I use that to my advantage. And also with the heal, you know, that's just healing you all along the way. So you're a little, you can survive a little bit more.
Yeah.
Corey, a lot of the heroes you played also had no escape, like Widowmaker.
Yeah, that's true. But I mean, even like Pharah and stuff like that, like Reinhardt.
D.Va has good escape.
Yeah, so it was like Tracer.
But another thing I really dislike about Overwatch is the time it takes for you to rejoin the battle after you die.
It's
a long walk, especially if you're a slow character. It takes forever. But with Lucio, you know, you put that speed song on and you amp it up and you're there.
Yep.
And it helps your teammates too, because that song spreads to them. So it mm-hmm. speeds them up and brings them back into the action as well.
Yep.
So I guess for me, it's just like Lucio is the one character that fixes the things I dislike about Overwatch.
Uh-huh.
Maybe there's some more. I don't know. I haven't played them all. I've played maybe 75% of them. Some of them just for one match kind of thing. But it's weird because I think people are still trying to figure out the best way to play that game. Because you really do have to change characters on the fly. You know, if something's not working, you got to change who you are.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And until go ahead.
As I said, it's my biggest complaint with people who say the game has balance issues. It's like, you gotta change your character and play counters.
Yeah.
Like, that's a huge part of the game. It's just like,
because you're going against Bastion, play Genji, Hayanzo, Widowmaker, Tracer. Yeah, to take them out. Don't just sit there and be like, this game needs balancing now.
I did have a little bit of an issue with Bastion. I do think he's a little overpowered.
But if you look at tier lists, he's like bottom tier.
I don't get that, though. Like, he because kills me so many times. My issue, well, my issue. Let me explain my issue first, and then you can rebut. But I played a lot of Widowmaker, and a sniper bullet rarely kills a person in one hit unless you get them in the head or they're, you know, kind of low on health. But one of Bastion's minigun bullets, of which he's cranking out 20 per second or whatever, kills you. Doesn't that seem crazy?
Well, he's shooting so many bullets in like a short span but that you don't know how many.
Just one nips you and it kills you.
I mean, Widowmaker is a squishy hero, too.
I'm not talking about the squishiness of the hero. I'm talking about their ability to kill. I think a sniper bullet should do more damage than one of Bastion's minigun bullets.
Well, as I said, he's shooting so many bullets so fast, it seems like one, but he's really pouring like 7-8 bullets into you.
I mean, that could be, but I was just like pumping people full of bullets.
Well, if you as Widowmaker...
just not getting kills. This was just one instance. I mean, I did have a lot of success with Widowmaker other times, but...
You're definitely right. With Widowmaker, if you... The moment when you shoot somebody, like... at 100% and don't kill them, that the charge meter with her, because the further that you have the scope in, the more damage like her shots do.
Yeah.
Like you're shooting and you pop off a bullet right away, basically like you're getting a very minimal amount of damage output when you pop off that second shot. So like that's part of the reason why Widowmaker sometimes doesn't kill right away.
No, I realize that, but even at 100% I still had that issue.
No, you're right. I definitely think that sometimes where if it's like in the chest, you think it would kill them and it doesn't.
Yeah.
There's some, I read a couple articles specifically on Bastion and some people actually had some good suggestions for quote unquote fixing Bastion. One of them was you can shoot your minigun bullets, but once you need to reload, then you have to come out of your turret mode and have a cooldown.
Yeah.
So, you know, you go out of your turret mode, you reload, and then you have like a whatever 10-second cooldown.
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, go ahead.
My fix was friendly fire. Bastion can do damage to his teammates, so he can't just crank bullets into the melee and only hit the enemies, you know? He's got to be a little more selective.
Yeah, that's interesting.
But I don't know. You're definitely right, Will, like there are ways to counter Bastion that people just aren't taking advantage of.
I mean, two off the top of my head right now, Genji deflects bullets. Like, he has an ability where he deflects bullets back at the enemy. Yeah. So when Bastion's firing at you, just use Genji and deflect them back at him and kill him. Another is Roadhog, who's a tank. He can hook heroes. Just, like, have him hook.
Yeah.
Hook Bastion out of position, and then he's useless.
Sometimes like, that's not an option, though. Like, when Bastion sets up in a corridor and you round the corner and just cranking bullets at you before you have time to react.
Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah. I don't know. I think there's issues there.
It's funny, like, I go to the Overwatch subreddit, and, like, it's now infiltrated by the people who just played the game, which is fine, but, like, the people who have been playing it since closed beta are getting annoyed because everybody's complaining and saying, this is overpowered, that's overpowered, and you're like, we've been here for the whole duration of the game and seen some, like, legitimately overpowered stuff.
Bastion used to be, like, really super overpowered.
Yeah, they nerfed him down a lot.
Well, now you sound like an elitist, Will.
No, it's just like...
Here's my thing. I played a lot of Overwatch matches, and I found myself getting immensely annoyed by Bastion. And I'm agreeing with you that there are workarounds, but I feel like it shouldn't be every game where I'm just like, oh, there's Bastion again. Like, just feeling like it's bullshit every time. I'm not sure what the fix is. Maybe there isn't one. Maybe you're right. Maybe just everybody needs to get better. But I don't know. I just found myself being taken out of the game because of Bastion on too many occasions.
Sure.
The other one...
It's also I keep on getting killed by the same hero. Like, because he's going to be picked all the time on defense missions or objectives because, like, that's his jam.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah,
I don't know. I just feel like that the more that I played, the more I could figure out how to counter him. Like I said, Genji is a direct counter, and it makes it a lot easier to take out Bastion. Or you can just be Bastion yourself and fire back at him. I don't know. I just feel like that a lot of it is people being exposed to the game for the first time and not knowing exactly how to counter stuff, and then therefore it's overpowered because they don't want to figure it out.
Yeah. No, you're definitely right. I think there's a bit of a learning curve in that, like, the way to play this game is not to get really good at one hero and use that hero and stick with it. It's like you have to change on the fly. You have to respond to what the other team has. And that's just like, it's kind of a new, I don't know of other games that do that.
It's like a MOBA in that way. You have to know what the other team's heroes' powers are.
Yeah.
You're useless if you don't know that Roadhog can hook you, you know, like you got to learn all that stuff. And there's a learning curve because of that.
Yeah.
You know, obviously you're still going to get hooked occasionally, but at least after you've played him a few matches, you know, that's potentially coming.
Yeah.
And it's you can go, Corey. I'll finish up later.
The other one that pissed me off was the guy that turns into the, like, wheel.
Junkrat?
Junkrat, yeah. And, man, every time that killed me, like, that pissed me off more than every time Bastion killed me, even though it was rare. But, like, I think the area effect on that is a little too big.
Yeah. And at least you can hear that coming, though.
You can. That's a good point. But and that's another thing. Like, you just have to... You have to learn, like, your brain has to connect those neurons to say, like, okay, you're running around, crazy shit's happening, but when you hear that sound...
You're like, oh, God.
Yeah, you gotta keep your eyes open.
No, yeah. Corey, I'm with you, because Junkrat and Roadhog were some of the ones that that bothered me, and the wheel was the same reason, because I played a lot of the offense heroes in the game, so they have a lot of, like, low hit points. And just, like, I heard that stupid wheel coming around the corner, and, like, I'm panicking trying to figure out where to run. And, of course, I run right into it, and then that makes me angrier. So, like, I get that.
Yeah.
100%.
Yeah. It's really clever, but he'd go up on the top of buildings, and then you'd hear it start up, and you'd look around and be like, I don't see it. And then it'd land on your head and kill, like, six of you or five of you, however many are on a team.
Yeah.
It's crazy. But again, like, I do kind of like that.
Yeah.
But it annoys me to no end. He annoys me less than the Bastion. It just pissed me off more because it was just, ugh.
My crux in playing Overwatch was Hanzo. And you guys know about my hatred for Hanzo, but I don't know if I talked about the podcast. But seriously, 9 times out of 10, when I would die in a match, I was killed by Hanzo. And I think I figured out that part of the reason it's hard to tell when he's shooting you with arrows, like harder than it is with Widowmaker. Cause, you know, he's a sniper like Widowmaker is. There's the bullet trail when you're getting shot by Widowmaker. But Hanzo's arrows are stealth, you know, and a lot of times I couldn't even tell when I was getting hit by one. And then obviously if you get hit in the head, it's a one shot, one kill. Mm-hmm. At least they made his ultimate like kind of easy to dodge if you see it coming, the dueling dragon thing.
Yep.
Because if they made that hard too, like, ugh, Hanzo, god dang it.
I love hearing like the heroes that bother people and count like always kill you. It's always funny because it's a lot of different heroes and it's
oh yeah, sure.
It's entertaining to hear like what people are like. I hate this hero.
Yep. No, nope, I got killed by Hanzo countless times. Frustrated.
Which is funny because I think I died by Hanzo maybe like twice or three times playing.
I wonder if it's the way I play, you know, like if I leave myself open to a Hanzo type of character. It'd be interesting to see like the breakdown of that.
Because I play Tracer, so it's really hard for Hanzo and Widowmaker to hit me.
Sure.
So I because she's so mobile.
Yeah, she's very hard to hit.
So, like, I guess that's sort of... And then, like, because I'm also play a lot of other offensive heroes, like, I'm, like, moving as fast as I can to get through area to area and try to avoid, like, being, I don't know, one spot long enough, I guess.
Yeah. So, Corey, are you going to get Overwatch?
I don't think so.
No?
Well, Tito brings up a good point in the chat. It's a way better game with a group of peeps, which is very true of
a lot of things.
Most games. But I feel like in this one, I would never play it without other people. Kind of like Heroes of the Storm, but at least Heroes of the Storm was free to play.
Yeah.
I find it really hard to drop $40 for this game that I had a mediocre time playing with Eric. It was kind of funny because we were playing, me, Eric, and Johnny, mm-hmm. friend of the show, Johnny, were playing Overwatch, and then we're like, you guys just want to play some Rocket League? And we switched to Rocket League, and we had infinitely more fun with the four or five games of Rocket League that we played versus the handful of Overwatch games that we played. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying it's a bad game. It just, I did kind of start to enjoy it a little bit once I had some success with Lucio and started to figure out a little bit more of the nuance of the game. And like, you do kind of have to change on the fly, and you have to learn multiple characters, and you have to hope that your team is able to change on the fly and, sure. and
yep.
rotate through multiple characters. But I didn't enjoy it enough to drop $40 on it, and I probably wouldn't play it enough to make that worth the money.
Sure.
Here's sort of what I equate it as. It's a shooter, so that shooter rage that everybody has comes out when we play it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because, like, everybody gets annoyed in shooters, I sure. think. Because it's probably the most competitive, like, online game, really, other than a sports game.
Oh, I mean, I can totally see the appeal for people who like competitive online shooters. I'm just not one of those people, so it's just not...
I'm not either, but I love Overwatch.
I find that crazy.
I do think that if you don't like shooters, Overwatch might be your best shot at liking a shooter, yeah. I guess.
A competitive online shooter.
Well, here's...
Overwatch.
I mean, yeah.
For somebody who doesn't like shooters.
Yeah, I think it has more than other shooters.
Yeah, I think what it has for me, and I've talked about this, one of the reasons why I like Halo... is because you can kind of tailor in Halo. You can kind of tailor your equipment and stuff to your playstyle, your abilities and stuff that you have, and that's kind of how Overwatch works. You pick a character that's tailored more towards your playstyle, if you will.
I don't know, Dan. I think Halo is a bad comparison to draw for that. I think Overwatch is infinitely more tailorable to your playstyle sure. than
that Halo. Was why I preferred Halo over like a Call of Duty.
Doesn't Call of Duty have more loadout options than Halo?
Not really. It's still like shoot in the head, you know, like Halo, early Halo, I should specify, you know, later Halo's a little faster, but yeah. You know, you had your shield so you could take a few hits. You know, a lot of different gun options. The science fiction-y stuff, you know, is yeah. enough to make a big difference. Sticky grenades, that stuff that you wouldn't get away with in Call of Duty.
Also, vehicles are a big thing in Halo.
Sure.
Yeah, it's for me, it's vehicles and survivability. I mean, Overwatch does give you some survivability options we talked about with Lucio, and I think that's why playing Lucio helped me enjoy that game a little bit. There are no vehicles, although that would be fun to have.
Maybe you'd like Tracer, Corey.
We'll see. I mean, I'm not... I would feel left out if, like, you guys were all playing one night and I didn't have it. I'd be like, oh, man. But I don't know. There are games I liked more that I haven't dropped $40 on or, you know.
Sure.
Yeah.
One other quick thing I wanted to talk about with Overwatch, and Will, you can talk about this, differences between the console version and the PC version.
Yeah.
Obviously, graphically, they're pretty similar, apparently. Frame rate's obviously better on PC. But Paul Tassi wrote a good article, Pros and Cons of the Console Versions, and one of the things he said, which I thought was funny, was the console players picked, you know, interesting hero makeups. They didn't quite have the concept of a good team build.
They really didn't.
Like PC players who, you know, are more used to or more familiar with like MOBA type of games. But Will, you can talk a little bit about that. We talked about that this weekend. I'll let you go ahead.
Yeah, I played a couple games on PS4 because one of my good friends is getting it for PS4. So I'm like kind of testing it out to see if I'm going to end up getting it or not. But so I played a couple matches online and one of them was a payload. And I kid you not, the other team picked three Reapers and didn't leave the starting zone and just fired bullets at us from the safe area to try and kill us, but didn't
go out and like openly confront us, except one guy who was Lucio was trying to do for the team, try to push the payload just himself. So like we're killing him, and they're like not leaving the starting area, just like trying to kill us. And it was hilarious. And like they weren't playing objectives, they're playing the same hero. Like three or four were the same heroes on a team. Like just not grasping the concept of like the team-based shooter that it is. And like my favorite character to play is Tracer because of the mobility and stuff like that. And just I love messing with people with games, and she's like the mess with people character in the game. And I was trying to play her, and I just couldn't get the feel of it on console very well, because like the aiming doesn't feel as good as a keyboard and mouse. I've always preferred shooters with keyboard and mouse anyway. So like when I go to shooters on like a console, it feels really weird to me. So like I was having that issue, and like trying to blink and like aim was so much harder with a controller. So I don't know if I'll be able to play Tracer on the PS4 version. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of like I can see people who don't have a PC getting this. Like I think it's a fine port for the most part. It's just like getting used to using the controller, because everybody's like abilities are mapped differently on the controller too, which is like a weird thing.
I used the controller quite a bit.
Did you?
I switched back and forth. Yeah.
You're a brave man.
You are a brave man.
I think it depends on the character, obviously.
Sure. Yeah.
It's a little bit easier using a character like Lucio with the controller than maybe like a Widowmaker or something.
Yeah.
Now, I ran into some people not doing the objective, too. Probably two or three matches I ran in was people going out trying to improve their kill death. But I don't think that's going to be a common thing.
Is that stat even tracked?
You have eliminations and deaths.
But there's no like kill-death ratio in your stat
not
readout.
Not that I saw. So I don't think that type of player is going to stick with the game, or if they do stick with it, they'll learn. Because I was all about winning, even if I had to play a character that I wasn't good as. If they would help the team in any way, I would be them. You know.
Yeah.
So, good stuff though.
Yeah, no, it's a good game, and I'm be interested to see what like changes Blizzard does from all of the people, because as I said, there was a lot of complaining, valid and not valid. So it'd be interesting to see what they pick to be like the stuff that they fix for the final release of the game.
I just hope it works when it launches. That's my thing.
I'm thinking it will, because if it works so well for the open beta,
yeah,
because it didn't go down, right?
Blizzard,
no,
it'll be fine.
I had no issues. Well, we thought that about Diablo 3.
Yeah, that was.
It worked for like a week, wasn't it?
Yeah. Really? It didn't work for like a week and a half.
That's right. Remember you logged in and it was like a 2-hour queue?
Yeah. Oh. And like
I couldn't, it wasn't even that. Like I couldn't, that was Knights of the Old Republic was the 2-hour, 3-hour, 5-hour queues. Diablo had the, is it
error code?
Error 37.
That's right.
Just couldn't connect for the longest time.
You couldn't stream more than like an hour of playing like together.
I think it was like a week that it was in rough shape before they got their crap together.
Honestly, the game didn't get good until like at least a year after.
Yeah.
I made my 67 cents off of it though, and I'm thrilled.
Nice. So that's all I played. Corey, let's hear about Stellaris.
Stellaris.
Stellaris. Stellaris.
So I've been having a little bit of a grand strategy crisis a little bit, because I recently played Civ 5 with all the expansions, like everything, and played one match and I'm like, I don't think I'll ever play this again. And I found myself sort of questioning, like, what does the grand strategy genre mean to me, and do I even like it anymore? I've always been into strategy games, starting with like an Age of Empires kind of thing, or even going back to the SNES, like Utopia, I guess you could consider a strategy game, which is a great game. But I was hesitant to play Stellaris, having tried Crusader Kings and not being able to penetrate that shell. But I like space. Love Master of Orion 2, one of my favorite games of all time. So I figured I'd give it a shot. So I picked my Civ, and you start, I guess Civ is the way to phrase it, but it's more like race. And I was started off as the United Nations of Earth, as close to home as I could get. And they give you these things called governing ethics, which are basically your empire's traits. Like in Civilization, your leader has traits that carry on throughout the game. And the governing ethics for the United Nations of Earth, from what I understand, they're random when you start the game. But this is what it gave me: xenophile and fanatic individualist. And the fanatic individualist description reads, "We must recognize that society is but a convenient fiction, the byproduct of individuals working toward parallel, overlapping, and contradictory goals, as it should be." Which sounds very human.
Sure.
You know, capitalist, I guess, almost. Yeah. You know, everybody working towards one their own good that happens to work for the greater good kind of thing. So I was the United Nations of Earth, and it does the. It's a 4X game: exploration, exploit, expand, exterminate. So right off the bat, you are given a science ship and a construction ship, and you use that those ships to explore, starting with the solar system around you. So I took my science ship, and they give you quests, especially when you're doing the tutorial, like. Tutorial-based quests, and it says the first one is to explore the system and survey all the planets and everything. And there are moons, like the popular moons, like Titan, are part of the solar system. A couple others that I can't remember off the top of my head. I think Europa's in there. So you send your ship out, your science ship, and it surveys all the planets. But there's also like quests that tie in to those planets. Like you'll survey a planet, and there will be an anomaly on there. And you can investigate the anomaly, and that might lead to another quest. There's a lot going on in this game, so bear with me. So your leader is fluid throughout the game, at least for the United Nations of Earth that I was. Their government style. There's elections every 5 years, I think it was. And the rulers themselves have different traits. So the current ruler I have in my game is, her trait is warlike, which means the ship and army costs are decreased. So I get that little benefit. So I've been spending a lot of resources on building up a fleet of ships that I didn't worry about before. And that election happens. It's democratic republic, kind of like we have elected representatives that we trust to choose our leaders for us. But that's from a pool of all your leaders. You have science leaders. You have admirals that are heads of your ship. And then there's governors that govern your planets. And your leader is based on one of those characters, and it pulls that character from, you know, your science or your ship or whatever. But influence is a resource in the game, and you can use your influence to nudge the election in one direction or the other. But when a leader is elected, they have mandates. They'll say, like, okay, I'm going to mandate that we're going to build 4 mining colonies during my term as leader. So if you do that, you earn a bunch of influence points that you can use as currency for other things. So it's just like, and that's just a very small part of the governing aspect of the game. So the exploit aspect of the 4X in Stellaris, mining and research stations, every planet, moon, whatever, that sun that you survey has some sort of resource attached to it. And depending on the type of resource, you can build a mining station or a research station to increase your currency. It's sort of like building a farm in Civilization. If there's a plot of land that's fertile, you build a farm on it, you get more food. In Stellaris, if you build a mining station around a sun that has, or star, I should say, that has, what's the word I'm looking for? Minerals, that will be added to your monthly allotment of minerals, and that's what the resources are based on, is monthly amounts. Also there's planet management, and that's sort of the Civilization, like putting populations on tiles. So once you go to a planet, it has a certain number of tiles associated with it, and you can build buildings on those tiles to get certain resources, and then you sign a population person to it to get more out of it. So there's that. There's also edicts you can put on a planet, and edicts are bought with those influence points I was talking about from before. One of the ones I use a lot of is the Land of Opportunity Edict. So on Earth, I institute the Land of Opportunity Edict, which increases migration to the planet by 100%. So all the species that I'm allied with or have some sort of agreement with, migration agreement, it increases their migration to my planet by 100%. And that's at the cost of your influence points. So there's that. There's also empire-wide edicts, which are like a basic monthly influence cost. So there's one called Information Quarantine. So if I click on that, it costs me one influence point a month. And what it does is that it prevents people from diverging on their own ethics due to outside influence. So if there's a civ nearby that has different ethics to yours, those people, your people can be influenced by that. But if you did something like the empire-wide information quarantine, they're less likely to be, to turn coat, I guess would be the best way to phrase it. One thing I really like about the game is that it's really well written, and they give you, at least early on in the game, from what I understand later on in the game, this sort of disappears, but they give you really compelling short-term and long-term goals. So like a long-term goal that I stumbled on was I was surveying planets, and I got this thing called, this quest called Mass Extinction Through the Ages. And what it is that it wants me to scan different types of planets, and it lists a bunch of them. Noxious, or however you pronounce that.
Noxious.
Noxious planet.
Noxious. Burned, Noxious.
Burned planet, broken planet, chilly planet, and desolate planet. And it wants me to find those in the Milky Way galaxy and scan them, with the idea being that these planets were not always that way, and what was the calamity that caused them to be that way. So you can sort of...
The Reapers.
Exactly. Yeah, the Reapers, sure. So you can avoid that for your own civilization kind of thing. So I found a couple of them so far. I'm still searching the galaxy for all of them. But that's an example of a long-term goal. A short-term goal could just be something as simple as, and it's to guide you in the right direction. It could be like, make sure you have plus 10 energy resources a month and plus 30 mineral resources a month. And then once you hit that point, it will complete the quest for you. So early on, I quickly surveyed all my planets and moons in Earth is solar system, and then Alpha Centauri is the next closest one, and then you send your ship out there to start scanning, and then it just kind of grows from there, and eventually you build colony ships and start settling other planets, all the while expanding your borders, meeting other alien races. It kind of worked out that the closest alien race to me shared my governing ethics. They were also fanatic individualists, which meant our relationship was immediately really good, just because we shared that commonality between our governments, which went a long way in building a friendship with that other race. But early on, I didn't bother with my space fleet at all, because I had a good friend nearby, no enemies within sight. But what happened because of that was space pirates popped up.
Oh.
Yeah, they were my own people that turned into space pirates, and they started pillaging my mining stations, which is a major hit to my resources. So I had to deal with them, which was kind of a pain. But the going back to my point before about how it's well written, there's some really interesting quests that pop up when you're surveying planets with your science ship. You'll see an anomaly, and then it's like its own little side quest. And then you'll send your science ship to investigate it, and it will say, like, you can investigate this, but there's a risk. And the risk could be, you know, you lose, your ship takes damage, or every science ship has a scientist who is one of your leaders aboard, and potentially they could die. And they tell you that early on in the game. And I came across this one, I don't know how familiar you guys are with the Serenity Firefly series.
Yeah.
But seen a little bit.
There was this one quest that I found. It was like a derelict ship out in the middle of nowhere that was just floating, no energy to it or anything. And I went to investigate it, and it said, okay, you can investigate this, but there's a 15% risk of failure. I was like, 15? That's pretty small. But my ship had my best scientist, 5-star scientist aboard. and I investigated it, and it said, like, oh, this ship, you don't really know what happened, but it's like space madness had taken over the ship, and people lost their minds and killed themselves or something like that. And that was the resolve of the quest, and I was like, oh, that's fine. But a little bit later on, like a couple months later, my ship that investigated with my best scientist on it went mad. Oh. It was almost like that madness spread to their ship, and the ship blew up, and I lost my best scientist because of that.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, and there's a lot of stuff like that. And that's the best part of the game. But from what I understand, that stuff all disappears once you get to the mid-game. Once you've explored, it's just a grind after that. And that was...
It's all diplomacy after that, right? Like, dealing with the other races?
Yes, but from what I understand, I haven't really gotten to that point. I'm almost to that point. The artificial intelligence is so bad that the diplomacy is no fun. And okay. I kind of saw that a little bit. I talked about the civilization that was nearby me. They were an avian species, the Mythfell Concord, they were called. And right away, like I said, we shared governing traits, so we had a good relationship off the bat. And I offered them open borders for civilians only, because you can offer open borders for military, civilians, and something else I can't remember. And I just offered them for civilians so that we could survey each other's planets just for that exploration purpose. So I offered them open borders. That was the only thing I offered from me and from them, and they refused it. But only a few short months later, they offered me a full alliance, which makes no sense. They weren't at war with anybody. You know, there was no reason for them to do that. And just... a couple months before that, they refused open borders for civilians.
So it's almost like it's random.
It seems. And I'm not the only one to complain about that. I ended up accepting the alliance, and it was kind of cool because once we were allies, they called our collective civilizations the Celestial Concord.
Oh, nice.
Sounds really awesome. And then eventually, like if you team up with a bunch of people, it could become a federation. And then you have Federation-specific ships, almost like the United Nations on Earth kind of thing. Like, they team up and they pool the best leaders from each civ and put them onto a ship, and they're, like, really effective from what I understand. So that's cool, but the AI to get there, I don't know, just makes no sense. And also what happens mid-game is that you're forced to sector off portions of your empire to be controlled by artificial intelligence governor, which is kind of good and bad because it eliminates some of the micromanagement from the game for you, but it eliminates some of the micromanagement from the game for you. And yeah. The IGN review I read, I'll quote here. He said, I forget the name of the reviewer. He gave it a 6.3, the IGN review. It was a UK guy. He wrote, sectors take the best part of Stellaris, planet management, and turn it into nothing. They don't do anything except contribute resources. I guess it, like, maybe if you're playing on a massive map with however many stars, it could be helpful. But, like you said, like, one of the best things about Stellaris is the planet management, something that would carry on throughout the whole game, like instituting edicts and putting governors on the planet and building certain buildings and putting population units on them and moving population units between all the planets. It takes all that away, and all you get is just resources.
Yeah, that's frustrating too, because I mean, we've talked about this before. One of the good things we liked about Civ 5 was your ability to micromanage or just macromanage as much as you wanted.
Yep.
So that was one of the cool things about it. If you wanted to really get down into the nitty gritty and micromanage every single city of yours, you could, even if you had a huge empire.
Mm-hmm.
That's fun for a lot of people that play that type of game, you know?
Absolutely. That's like basically how the game works. One of my biggest issues with the game, though, because I haven't seen that mid-game slog yet. I'm not quite there. So far, it's been very good. But my biggest issue with the game so far is the space immersion. One of the reasons I love space games is because I love, like, seeing outer space. But they don't do much graphically to immerse you in space. The galaxy map is pretty boring. And even within, like, certain star systems, it's pretty boring, the art style. And even when you have like pop-ups from quests and stuff like that, they reuse the same graphic over and over and over again. That is just not interesting. Like, you'll discover a new species, but it'll be the same graphic as the last five species you discovered. Which isn't very exciting, you know?
Yeah.
It's like, well, why does this one look exactly the same as the other one?
Sure.
I don't know. But like I said, the early game stuff and the writing is so good, and the spacey stuff they come up with is so clever. Like, I discovered a species that is synthetic, but they raise organic slaves to, like, run their ships. It's really cool. Like, it's that kind of stuff. It's fascinating. But, again, from what I understand, that stuff sort of disappears mid-game, and it's just a slog. And that IGN review I talked about, he gave it a 6.3. People, I guess, reacted very angrily towards that review. Paradox actually issued a statement today. Was it today?
Yeah, I think it was this morning.
In response to that, basically standing up for the IGN reviewer and saying he's well-equipped, he's played a lot of our games, and he said in his review he played multiple 20-hour sessions of Stellaris, yeah. So... though they disagreed with him, they stood up for him, which is nice. Sure.
Yeah.
But also what I've seen a lot of people note is that Paradox does not give up on their games.
No, they don't.
So maybe we'll see a lot of interesting things added that sort of eliminate that painful slog through the middle of the game. I guess endgame stuff is really interesting, too. I haven't gotten to that point.
To bring up Crusader Kings 2 again... one of the complaints about it was the Mongol invasions are so powerful, like, you know, kind of early-ish game, like the 1100s, that to balance that's why they came out with the Aztec invasions from the west, because the east was so decimated, you know, it kind of left the central Eastern Central Europe kind of decimated, ripe for conquest from the West.
Yeah,
that they use the Aztec invasions, which I know are not historical, but they use that as like a counterbalance to the Mongol invasions.
I don't think this game is as deep as Crusader Kings 2, but I could be wrong.
I don't know that any.
It sounds like up my alley.
I picked up on this one pretty quickly. Granted, the tutorial. Stuff is far better than anything I saw in Crusader Kings 2, so maybe that has something to do with it.
Yeah. Okay. I definitely want to try it.
Yeah, it's good. It's so far, you know, I haven't seen the bad stuff yet, so.
Right. Okay. Did you play anything else, Corey?
I don't think so.
All right. William.
Hi.
What do you got?
I played a little Uncharted 4. Now, I said I wasn't going to talk too much about it because we're doing an episode on it next week. So I'll just say that I really like it so far. Uncharted, somebody in the chat said this, that the other Uncharteds didn't really look that interesting. And I'm kind of in an agreement with that. I've never been interested in Uncharted. But playing the fourth one so far, I'm like super interested in it, and it's a lot of fun. I really like there was like this moment in the early game where you got to play Crash Bandicoot, like the first level of Crash Bandicoot.
What?
And it was like a cutscene, and you got to control it, and it was so cool. Like, I don't know.
Nathan Drake hanging out at home, and you played his PlayStation or something.
Yeah, he was talking to his wife, and he said he could beat his wife's score.
Nice.
And that's what he did. It's so much fun so far. And, like, technically, this game is just super impressive. Just, like, the environments, like, all the environments have been super different and whatnot. And I don't know what's going on with the characters because I don't know who's been in past games and who's not. So, like, I'm trying to figure that all out. But, like, I'm super into the story right now and like, what has to happen and why... like Nathan Drake has to get back into like treasure hunting. So the basis of the story is like he's retired from doing the treasure hunting and all the adventures and whatnot, and like this one he has to get back into it. Huh. And that's like that's nice. The gist of it. And like there's a moment when he's in his office area and he's looking at all the treasure that he's collected throughout the other games, I'm assuming they're from the other games. Like, it's all really cool, and, like, it makes me want to go back and play the old ones. And I looked at the Uncharted collection and saw I could get it for $30, which doesn't seem too bad of a deal. So I'm kind of interested in doing that. I don't know if I'll like the other ones as much, and I don't know if, like, the Rise of the Tomb Raider helped me like these games more, because that game was super awesome, and it's in the same sort of vein as that. But, yeah, I really, really am liking Uncharted so far. I'm going to try and have it beat by next week, so I can have a lot more of an opinion on it.
Nice.
But yeah, so that's Uncharted 4. What was I going to say? I played Diablo 3. I did my first season character.
Wow.
Which I've never done before. So basically, me and Johnny said, let's do Diablo 3. Because I started playing Diablo 2 again with my friends. And we did a little bit of Diablo 3. And then we said, I don't want to level up to 70 right now. So we got onto somebody to power level us. So we got our characters to level 70. And now we're doing the like grinding for gear and whatnot.
What?
Because I've never done that. And I really want a cool looking wizard.
Nice.
Yeah.
You nerd.
Diablo 3 is a really good game.
Yeah, I still need to go back to it. I got to get the expansion first, though.
Me too.
I'm kind of wondering if they're going to do another expansion for Diablo 3, because it's been 2 years since the last one.
Oh, yeah. We'll get another one.
Which I was really surprised they haven't announced anything, and they kind of reset the story. So, like, because all the primevals at the end are, like, set free again. So, like, there's going to be a Diablo 4, basically.
Not for another 10 years.
Do you know what's interesting about, like, the old, like, Blizzard franchises that were, like, the big three were StarCraft, World of Warcraft, and Diablo? It's weird, because StarCraft, as they said, is in, like, indefinite, like, I don't know, like, they're not doing anything with it right now.
Yeah.
After Legacy of the Void, World of Warcraft is losing a ton of subscribers and whatnot, and not doing as well as it once was. So, like, Diablo 3 is, like, the only one that's, like, still trucking along.
Yeah. And then Overwatch is coming out soon.
Yeah, then there's the new ones like Hearthstone and Overwatch and Heroes of the Storm that are making them all the money right now. Yeah. I just thought it was interesting that like the big three franchises weren't doing as well as their newer ones are seem to be doing.
I want to see Warcraft 4, not World of Warcraft.
Yeah.
I want another real-time strategy Warcraft game.
I think they said that they're not opposed to doing another RTS Warcraft, but I could be wrong. Maybe they said they weren't going to do another Warcraft 4 unless they figured out something gameplay-wise.
They'll do it. They'll definitely do it. Are you kidding me?
You know how giddy people would be
when
they announce Warcraft 4?
I'd be one of them.
Yeah,
I'm, me too. I'm
done.
I'm giddy for the new Warhammer game, Dawn of War, and I don't even really care about Dawn of War that much. So I'd be all for Warcraft 4. Maybe that's what they're gonna do because StarCraft 4 is like on or StarCraft series is on hiatus, sort of. Maybe that's what the RTS team will do.
Yeah.
Trying to think of what else I played this week. A lot of Fire Emblem Revelations. I could do a Fire Emblem podcast. I've decided. Stop.
Will, by all means, you can do one and just publish it on YouTube.
I would need another person. Probably Dan.
I'm not the one. Honestly, of all the games we've talked about this year, when you guys talk about Fire Emblem, I get so bored.
I understand it.
It's one you have to play.
Yeah, it's definitely not one that listening to people talk about is any fun.
No, I agree. I agree with that.
Like I said, as soon as I have Revelations beat, I'm going to like have you take my 3DS and you can play. I have all three games, so you can play any of the stories that you want. Let me ask you, Corey, which one are you interested in out of all of the three?
I don't really care. Any of them.
Well,
he should probably start with Birthright, right?
That's what I was thinking.
Whichever one gives the biggest Fire Emblem experience.
Conquest, then.
I don't know.
Did you like Awakening a lot?
Yeah.
Then you'd like Birthright then, probably.
Conquest is not for the faint of heart.
Yeah, I don't care about that. I don't need a challenge.
Yeah, Birthright would probably be the best bet then.
Yeah. Oh, Dan, I did want to tell you, when you do Revelations, I'm going to give you a tip. Make Elise a Dark Falcon.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Because if you buy the games, they give you the different scrolls. You know that, like, crystal ball, that random crystal ball?
Yeah.
That's the new thing. You just go there, and that's how you get all of that stuff.
Okay.
So, yeah, make her a Dark Falcon, because pretty awesome.
Nice.
All right. Trying to think of what else. Played Uncharted, played Diablo, played Overwatch. That's about it, I guess.
Okay. Shall we do feedback?
Sure.
All right. This is from Idaho Jake, who says, "Sorry guys for the absence, but I've been overworked and underpaid, so I'm looking for a better job." Well done. Nothing wrong with that. "I really hope Dan and Corey record a spoiler cast after the show on Game of Thrones." Corey?
Yep.
Let's do it.
I'm in.
All right. All I will say is Uncharted is a buy in this guy's eyes. Now for the question. What game made you go, "Oh shit, this game made me a gamer"? For me, I was on and off gaming until I discovered Elder Scrolls games. Well, thanks, fellas, and get out of my email.
Elder Scrolls is a good pick for that. I remember when I wasn't playing very many games and Skyrim came out, I went to the midnight release, and then I spent the whole day playing it the next day.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good pick. I mean, before that, like, I would spend countless hours playing EverQuest. Before that, like, I can remember staying up all night to play Legend of Zelda for Super Nintendo. What was the subtitle for that one?
The Past.
Yeah. Oh, man. Even before that, like, Super Mario World was one that really had me hooked. There's a ton of games I could point to.
I've really been, like, I would say a gamer since the beginning. Like, I remember going to our neighbor's house and playing Mario for the first time, and I was hooked then. I knew that video games were going to be my thing. Yeah. It was a little harder when we were younger because we didn't have access to all the games and stuff we have now as adults, you know.
Do you remember when little guy let us borrow his PlayStation?
Oh yeah.
And Crash Bandicoot being one of the games, speaking of.
I think we rent Final Fantasy Tactics at that point.
That could be.
First time we played it, we rented it from the local Video King.
Yeah.
But probably it would probably be a game like that really solidified my gaming was Final Fantasy VI, I would have to say. One of my friends got that when it launched. His mom brought it home. She went and got it for him after she got out of work, and I was there waiting for it with him. I fell in love with that game like immediately. That's kind of what, I don't know, made me decide that, as a little bit older of a person, that gaming was going to be my thing, you know?
Yeah.
I love the characters. I love the story. I sat with him as he played like the first 4 hours of the game or something like that.
That's cool.
Good stuff. Scram, by the way.
Of course. The man, the myth, the legend. Episode 13?
13, I think it was.
We got to have him back on soon.
We really do.
It's kind of funny, though. I feel like it's one of those the apprentice has surpassed his master kind of thing, you know? Like,
oh, sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he definitely doesn't do as much. I know he still plays a lot of games, but probably not as much as we do.
No. We're crazy. That's why we're such big losers.
The amount of hours I spent on some of the games I've played this year, like, already.
Hours and money.
Hours and money, yep.
I take that question a step further and ask, like, what game was it that made you, like, appreciate games beyond just being a, like, entertainment hobby?
I got a couple.
Like, I hesitate to use the word, like, appreciate games as an art form, because people get all pissy when I say that, but...
Sure.
I think it's an important question. So I had this conversation with some people the other day about, like, video games having the stigma of you know, and I got really, I actually got a little annoyed, but that's typical with me when it comes to games, like how games are so at least popularly hated, that stigma that they're hated, but yet those same people watch really bad TV,
yeah,
and like somehow that's more acceptable. Yeah. But you can't, like, you can't sit there and say, like, no, there's some, like, really interesting games that are creative and
just try playing To the Moon without weeping at the end of it.
Yeah.
You're dead inside if you don't cry at the end of that game.
Would you point to that, Dan, as your game that pushed games to another level?
Probably a little bit. I don't know that I had ever, like, wept playing a video game to that point.
Yeah.
I got a little like starry-eyed when Final Fantasy VII, a certain character dies. If you haven't played that, spoiler from what?
Sephiroth.
Yeah, when a certain character kills another character, you know, you get sad and starry-eyed. But like, I legitimately cried like a baby at the end of To the Moon. Legitimately cried like a baby.
That's a good example.
And there's other games that do that now, like. That Dragon Cancer is apparently supposed to be a very sad game. You know, Corey
Its moments. Yeah. Wouldn't recommend it, but it has its moments.
Sure. Yeah. I would hold up To the Moon as up there in game changers.
Will?
Okay, so answering the first question.
Yeah, answer Jake's question, and then I'm curious for science.
Okay, so for moments that I realized that I'm a gamer, one of them would be when I was little, and I was playing games like Age of Empires 2, Unreal Tournament 1999, and Final Fantasy Tactics at like a very young age, and like understanding the dialogue and like the gameplay and how to command armies at the age of like 2 or 3 and typing torpedo.
Yeah.
So I could cheat in Age of Empires.
You were pretty young.
But like, as I got older, it's hard to explain because like, I didn't lose the playing video games until the podcast, but like I played a lot less than I ever have.
Yeah.
So, like, when I realized, like, I was a gamer when I played through, like, the Call of Duty World at War as much as I did, and then playing, like, the Mass Effect series and Fallout 3. Like, Fallout 3 is another example because I didn't have an Xbox 360 at the time or a computer that could play Fallout, and I beat Fallout 3 on Dan's Xbox, like, 3 times. I beat it on your Xbox, Corey, a couple times, and, like, I beat it on my sister's when I would stay at her apartment. Like, I had beaten that game probably, like, 8 or 9 times on the 360. And then when I got my own, like, I beat it a couple times.
Mass Effect's a good choice, for sure.
And realizing that, like, video games made you appreciate video games more, to your question, Corey, like, one of the moments that I always remember is a lot of Mass Effect 3, actually, like, when Morden dies. Mm. And he's, like, up in the tower doing the singing the song, which, like, brings you back to Mass Effect 2 and like all the like times you had with Morden and then him sacrificing himself for the greater good and whatnot. And then like when Thane died, who was one of my favorite characters from Mass Effect, like that scene where his son's in there and you're in there and like they do that prayer, like what a like a beautifully shot scene that they did in that game. And like that was like a moment that I was like, this is like my favorite character who's dying and like he's
has to be me. Someone else might have got it wrong.
Exactly. Exactly. And that's like a AAA game that's made by like hundreds of people, and it's not even like the indie games, which there's a ton of indie games like To the Moon that like have had that effect that, you know, that this is bigger than just like a stupid video game. Like I think Life is Strange is another game that has a really good message and story arc in it that I still remember and I still tell people to play.
Well, that's just it. Like, you know, I think it's kind of elitist and prickish to say like that video games don't tell valid stories. I think in a lot of cases the stories they tell are better than a story you sit and watch on a TV. Because you're part of the story. You're not passively sitting and watching something. You are the, you know, you are experiencing the story as it happens from the perspective of the main character, whoever that may be, or the character that you yourself create.
Yeah,
exactly. And that's why, to answer my own question a little bit, I always point to games like Flower and Journey from that game company. Yep. Braid and Limbo are perfect examples. Like, they combine video gaming and, like, the unique, in terms of storytelling, the unique aspect that video games have in that you are controlling that. And what does it mean to be controlling the character and how that relates to the broader message of the game? And I think those games are really good examples of that.
I've been saying for a few years now that I think video games are like the highest form of art.
Yeah, because it's all, if you think, mind. It's everything.
Exactly. Exactly. Like music, music is a big part of like my life because I listen to it so much, and like storytelling's like a big part of it, and like visuals and whatnot, and like video games is everything into one.
Yeah.
So like, I don't know. I've always thought it's like the highest form of art.
I could sit there and play 60 stupid hours of Stardew Valley, but for some reason the 2 hours of Kardashian is more culturally acceptable than my Stardew Valley.
Yep.
I don't know. I really don't. Whatever.
It's just like I'd rather play 60 hours of Stardew Valley than sit down and want to study for a biology test.
You'll never convince those people to get out of their own asses. You just won't.
And honestly, though, I feel like a lot of them would admit that. They'd be like, I don't get it. I'll never get it. I'm going to watch my shows, and that's way better than your stupid little games that you play. And like, the only thing you can do is be like, well, eventually you'll all die off. You know, it's the case with anything. You know, like, eventually you'll all die off, and opinions will change, and, you know, the stigma will...
Sure.
Fade.
Yeah,
because, I mean, I you know, gaming only became a thing, like, since we were younger, and it's only gotten more popular as time has gone on, you know?
Yeah.
The amount of people that have never played a video game is getting smaller.
Yep.
So. You know?
Good chat.
Yeah, that was good.
Anything else?
I do have one thing.
Let's hear it.
Savage in the chat, Savage RL of Rocket League fame. We were chatting earlier about Final Fantasy a little bit, and he had never played a Final Fantasy game, and I kind of postulated, like, at this point in time, what is the Final Fantasy game you recommend to people to get into Final Fantasy? And my knee-jerk reaction was, I don't think there is one.
No, I think you missed the boat. I mean, not saying you can't go back and enjoy like a 6 or a 7 or Tactics, but I feel like in our case, a lot of why we still love those games is nostalgia, you know? I mean, I think they hold up to a certain extent, but if you're not, and none of the more recent Final Fantasy games are very good.
No.
Well, the
first question I asked is, are you into like retro game, like vintage games, 16-bit RPGs and
Earthbound?
I've never really played those. So for somebody like that, it's like, well, what Final Fantasy do you recommend to them? I mean, 7 is really, I mean, it's good, but it's so outdated at this point.
It even feels more outdated than 6.
Yeah, definitely.
It doesn't hold up as well as 6, I don't think.
I'd say if we like decide on 7, to just wait for the remake.
Yeah.
Maybe Type 0 is like the the end to Final Fantasy at this point.
The problem with Type 0 is like, if you're if you're gaming on a PC, you use 60 frames per second, going back to playing on 30 is awful. Yeah. It's an eyesore.
I mean,
maybe Tactics on your mobile.
Tactics on mobile is a good choice, because that's something, you know, you would play when you don't have the option to play anything else.
Yeah.
You
know? You're forced to.
That's usually when you play a mobile game, when you're sitting on the toilet pooping, or waiting in a doctor's office or whatever. You're right. And that one is one of the ones that plays decently with touchscreen controls. Whereas I don't think like 6 plays very well with touchscreen controls, because you have to constantly hold your hand on the screen to move around and stuff. That one's turn-based, you know, it's tap, 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 tap. So that, you're probably right. That would probably be the best one. It's expensive, though. If you want to get into that, wait for a sale. Occasionally, they'll have it for like 50 iOS or Android.
But even even that's kind of a departure from the standard Final Fantasy series, you know?
Yeah.
So even that isn't really a great choice. Final Fantasy IX on mobile is reviewing relatively well.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that was it was a good.
It's really hard to recommend one because I don't want them to play it and then hate it.
Yeah, especially if you have to.
Relatively well.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that was it was a good.
It's really hard to recommend one because I don't want them to play it and then hate it.
Yeah, especially if you have to spend money.
Yeah.
Like I hate recommending something to someone where they spend money on it and don't like it. Like it's one thing if you just waste a little time or whatever, but. Yeah, it's a tough call.
That is a tough call. I mean, I don't know.
I liked Final Fantasy Dimensions on mobile. That's not old school Final Fantasy. I mean, it is in that style, but it just came out a couple years ago.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That's okay. A long-ass game. Like, if you're not committed, forget it.
It's, I mean, like, they're all long.
Well, yeah, I just have a really hard time recommending it to a newcomer, any of the games.
I don't know. Ten and Ten Two
is coming out on PC tomorrow. The remaster's already on PS4.
Those were probably the last highly rated ones, too, weren't they?
Yeah, maybe that's an option.
Yeah.
But yeah, Beardless says in the chat, 15 seems like it's going to be the most successful Final Fantasy game. Yeah, I think the right answer is just wait for 15 to
come
out.
Wait for 15, yeah. And then if you like it, maybe go back and try some of the older ones. Although gameplay-wise, I don't think that's similar to any of the other ones, except for maybe Type-0 would be the closest to, because it's isn't supposed to have a more action-y type combat than the ATB system or the turn-based tactics like we're used to.
Yep.
I guess, does Savage have a Vita or a PS3 by any chance, do we know?
I do not know the answer to that question, but I'm sure he'll answer.
Sure.
Savage, if you have a Vita or a PS3, you could get, because you said you don't like playing games on your phone, like Tactics and 6 maybe on the PlayStation. One of those systems might be better for you if you want to try them, but like I said, maybe waiting for 15, and then if you're interested, going back.
It's only a matter of time before Tactics is on PC too, I would think.
Yeah, you're right. It should be soon, right?
Really you think. Should, yeah.
I'm going to look that up, actually, and to see Steam. What they say.
I mean, there's the emulation route, but only do that if you own a legal copy, legally backed up copy.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. That was a good conversation. Will, are you finishing looking up something?
I'm looking to see if there's any word on Tactics on Steam, and it doesn't look like it so far.
No, there hasn't been any even rumors for it, but it's only a matter of time before that comes out on Steam, on Steamy too.
Yeah, I mean, because they announce it pretty quickly from when it's going to come out, right, anyway?
Yeah, I mean, 10-2, people knew that was coming out for Steam, but it was just made official like a few days ago.
Yeah.
What, in a couple weeks or something?
Yeah.
So... Okay. Any other thoughts?
No.
I had something, but I don't remember.
Stay tuned for Game of Thrones.
Yeah, we're going to do Game of... Me and Corey are going to talk some Game of Thrones in just a few minutes here. So stay tuned after the outro. We'll talk some Game of Thrones to this point. Maybe some speculations on episode 4.
Major spoilers.
Major spoilers, yes. Do not listen if you are not caught up. I wish my dog would stop barking. It's driving me crazy. Uncharted 4 for next week. Thanks for... that'll do it for episode 251. I'm your host, Dan.
Will.
Corey.
Thanks for listening, and get out of my basement. All right.